morning, good afternoon, and even good evening for some of you. I'm glad to be with you today to talk about the Mises Fundamentals. So I will be your guest. I'm Alexandre Dulaunois, and Sami Mokadem will join us too. So we will share the session together. So we are doing it in a kind of interactive session mode. So that means everyone is really welcome to collaborate, ask questions, ideas, things like that. We really like that. So don't hesitate to collaborate. There are different ways of doing collaborations. Either you can use a Zoom Q&A, you can use a Zoom chat, or you can even use the active document that we have, which is sharing the chat, which is a document kind of notepad where people can have a look at the different things during the session. So the agenda is there. Some additional details like the virtual box and the VMware images for the one that want to do more stuff with Mises later on, and an access to a Mises training session, so a Mises training server where you can use during the sessions to play with Mises and so on. And we will do some kind of interactive sessions where people can play around. So don't hesitate, don't be shy. I mean, we are there to work with you on this. So don't hesitate to share questions and so on. So for the session of today, we will have a quick introductions of Mises for the one that doesn't know it, how it works, what are the background of Mises, the history behind it, and how you can use it. Then we will go more into usage aspects, including incident report handling. We will have some nice example, funny example from movies, how to encode data in MISP. And we will show you some different MISP events to see good practices of people sharing threat intelligence and stuff like that. Then we will go more into collaboration and sharing. So we will explain how to use MISP as a tool for doing the collaboration and sharing, and especially for the specific features that we have called distribution, sharing groups, proposals, delegations, and stuff like that. So it's really important there because MISP is really focusing on sharing, and we are really glad to have a lot of people from different regions today because we want that people are using MISP for sharing. It's really the core functionality of MISP and the act of sharing. Then we will have a small break because it's a kind of 4-hour session, so it might be a bit long then. Then we will talk about community building. So we'll share with you our experience of how we manage in the past year different communities and how we have seen, I would say, successful communities and communities that were a bit, I would say, less successful, so like that you can, you know, learn from mistakes and build better communities in the future. Then we will go more into threat analysis sessions. We have some new advanced CTI features in MISP like Galaxy 2.0, event report, timeline, and things like that. And we'll show you some examples of events that are interesting, investigation that we perform and so on. So here you can see how different organizations are structuring information, contextualizing, describing TTP, attack, course of action, things like that. And we'll do a quick introduction there of for the one that want to go deeper into MISP about API access and so on. It's not obviously a full-blown API training, but just like you know where to look at and to start to play with the API of MISP, because it's one of the additional things, sharing and having automations, which is, I think, key and important in MISP. And then we will close the session of today with administrations, how to deal with organizations and so on. So I think this one is really an important one if you want to build your own ISAC, sharing groups, sharing communities, you're building a new CSIRT and you want to have a kind of logical way of creating organizations and so on. It's really quite flexible. At the same time, being flexible means that it's quite powerful, but you have a lot of features and so on. So we will dig into that and see the different aspects. Okay, so don't hesitate to ask questions in the chat, in the pad, or directly in the QA session. So both of us are online, and then we'll have a look at it. And I don't mind to answer live questions that you might ask from the current topic, or even different one, as long as it's related to MISP, obviously. But that's a thing that you can do. Okay, so I will start first with a quick introduction of MISP, and especially the cybersecurity part and how MISP has evolved over time. So MISP is not a young software. MISP has more than 10 years of existence. The software has grown into something very generic and that you can use for various things. And I will go into details of all these things came along. And that's interesting because you can transpose maybe the history of your use case and all your different teams are actually collaborating and all you the day-to-day activities, incident response, security operations center, and others. First, for us, MISP was created really from a real need and a real background there. So in 2012, we did work on a very specific case between different European countries. We had kind of physical regular meetings on a quarterly basis. And we discovered that at that meeting, we did work on a specific malware, which was already something that another team in another European country was already working on. Which we find this as a kind of a pity, because the problem of it is when you start to work collaboratively and so on, you need to have kind of a platform to share that kind of information. And that's where everything started. So a friend of us started to do a work called CyDevSeek. It's Christophe Van de Pla, and he did a bootstrap of the early MISP versions, which later became the MISP project and so on. So it has really the initial step. And the first step that we did, which was, I think, quite successful, was to make it open source. It was a decision that we decided from the early beginning because we think that this tool could be used by others. And that's where everything started too, is based on a use case, which was, I think, limited at that time for just two CSIRs or three CSIRs communicating about reversing analysis and so on, we get an increase of feedback from different users in different fields, intelligence, border controls, analysts in various areas and so on, financial analysts, financial fraud analysts and so on. So, and nowadays, MISP is really a community-driven development project. So that's why today we are very interested into your feedback, your specific use case and so on, especially even talking about limitation of MISP that you are currently facing, for example, are very interesting to us because like that we can improve the software and make it better. So just a side note, because you know we need during sessions and so on to introduce ourselves, but I do work for Circle and I'm leading the team and one of the security researchers there. We are part of a cybersecurity agency in Luxembourg. We are under the NIS directive and we are the third for the private sectors and non-governmental entities in Luxembourg. So, which is interesting at the same time because we are really user of MISP. So we have our use case as a CSIRT and we do the development. So it's not separated. There is no separation between the development process and the use case processing. It's really the same people developing and using the software. So it's important for us. So just a side note, because people are asking, because when you start to use MISP, maybe you want to be sure that the software will be continued, developed on the long terms, and you want to be rest assured that this software is actively maintained, funded by different organizations, which is the case for MISP. First, Circle is funding the development of MISP, and we have different organizations supporting us and doing development. Especially, for example, the European Commission's did a series of fundings through the CEF program to allow us to extend MISP, especially the training materials and things like that. Next to the software itself, there's something important, and we'll talk about that because sometimes there's some discussion about this. Don't forget, MISP is a software. If you run a MISP alone somewhere, it's your community. So we have no, I would say, control of what you are doing with the software and so on. It's a complete open source software. You have the full control of what's going on in your software. So that's really important for us too. So that means we don't know about all the communities that are operating MISP, but we know some of them because as Circle 2, we develop the software, but we are also operating MISP sharing communities for others. So meaning that we maintain communities and so on. We'll talk more about communities and things like that. But it's really important there. When you run your software, you're completely autonomous and you can really do whatever you like. And afterwards, we'll explain how to bridge those communities because you can exchange information between those different communities to make the sharing not only within your community, but with other partners. And one of the partners, for example, can be First, FricaCert, and others. For example, First is running MISP too, so you can plug your MISP to the First. If you're First member, you can benefit from the MISP usage then. So usually a lot of people are asking the questions, what is MISP, what is it all about, and so on. Because, you know, some organization and people like to put some stuff in the box. So MISP started as a kind of platform for sharing IOCs, but nowadays it's a complete TIP. So it's a completely trade intelligence platforms with a strong emphasis on the sharing aspect. So it's what we call a trade information sharing platforms, which is completely free and open source. And that's quite important for us too. We want to be sure that it remains always open source, that people get the autonomy, and that every contributors get each part or each block of the software as their own too. And one of the first goals of MISP is to do the collection. So that means if you have partners like First and others, you want to collect indicators, information, trade intelligence from others, you can use MISP as a way to collect. And you can do that from automatic tools. You have connector for different kind of MISP tooling and so on, but you can do it as an analyst tool. So that means it's a software that can be used as a human interface with analysts. And that's usually mixed model. We have seen a lot of organizations using MISP where you have a lot of analysts working and at the same time, different kind of toolings, expanding informations, completing or even creating events. Then one of the goals of MISP when we structure information is to normalize it, to be sure that the format is standard, that the information injected is correct and so on. We can talk about that later, but it's quite important that the definition of MISP about what are attributes and so on is quite important because we want that the information that when we share it is basically consistent across the different MISP communities. Then is this one, I would say, big advantage of MISP is the correlations. When you start to ingest data into your MISP instance, you basically benefit from the correlations. So if, for example, I do work on a specific campaign, then we have Sami working on another analysis, and then we start to see that, oh, there are some correlation between the attributes, meaning that maybe we are working on the same case, or maybe working on the same kind of trade actors working on the same things, and so on. So correlation is really, really important. Then when you are an analyst, one of the goals, obviously, is to be sure that this information is validated, qualified, and so on, and the enrichment is one way to do it. So for example, if you want to plug it with passive DNS, passive SSL, you want to extend it to social network validation, things like that, we have plenty of modules to do that and to do the enrichment. And obviously, when you have that, you want to collaborate. So you have all this information into a MISP instance, and what you want to do is to be able to collaborate, communicate with others, validate it and so on. So we'll show you some functionalities like sightings, where you can, for example, de-qualify the information. So for example, if an indicator looks like shady or incorrect, or it's generating a false positive, you have plenty of way to announce it to others, to tell that for you, it seems to be a false positive. So the collaboration is really key there. And then when we have this kind of structured information, it's kind of, you know, logical way of doing things. You can provide this information and structured information back into some systems. Could be, for example, endpoint protection device, could be EDR, XDR, whatever, you name it. Could be intrusion detection system and so on, where you can inject the data. For example, we support plenty of formats like Suricata, Zeek, and others to inject automatically indicators, for example, from MISP into a specific system. And we do that for various things. So you can, for example, inject back things into VariusTotal for doing Yara search and so on. We have a nice example today to show to you how we track a specific trade actors using Yara rules. So you see that you can really feed the system back and improve your data. So just side note about how the software evolved, and that's a lot of confusion there because the original name of MISP was Malware Information Sharing Platform, but it was really at the early beginning of the platforms, we were really working on malware reversing and so on. But nowadays it's really a trade intelligence platform, so MISP is just MISP and you can share whatever you like. We will show about it too, about the data modeling aspect, where you can model your own data and structure it in your own way to be able to share this kind of information. But the thing is, nowadays, the platform is used in different fields, and those kind of contributions came from a various set of different contributors and users. So when you start to collect information, you see that other people are interested in, like security analysis, intelligence analysis, because it's completing their analysis. And you start to find overlap, things like between actors, your attribution, and so on. So if you have an analyst working on the attribution aspect, by looking at the techniques, the tactics that the attacker are using, you can build really active analysis and make it better. And that's how MISP contribution is coming on from. It's coming from different field of activities. And when you have more and more organization and different use case, the platform has been extended to support that. And that's why we have a lot of flexibility on the data model. It's really based on the different users that you receive. So it's not an exhaustive list that you see there, but it's a list of, I would say, regular organizations and field of activities that are contributing back to MISP and doing improvement. But nowadays, as the platform is quite generic and flexible, we have plenty of role and so on contributing back to MISP and improving it. So how do we get contribution back? And this one is why we mentioned that is people are asking about governance of MISP and so on. So we do on a regular basis release usually every 3 weeks with new features, improvement, and so on. And how do we prioritize that? It's really based on your users. So we do user groups. We participate to some user groups that we don't manage, but that are managed by other parties. And from those user groups, we collect the requirements, the different use cases from those different organizations. And that's really helping us to improve the software. So today, don't hesitate if you have any idea and so on. I remember a lot of features that you have not been missed came from our trainings. So from discussion with others. So it's really important. You can really play a role here and helping the community to make it better. Thing that we are trying to is to make it quite flexible too and innovative. So we have, for example, some features that are first experimental and going into more advanced one. And Sami is one of the author of this, one of the features. For example, one is the decaying of indicators, which is a very nice model where you can customize decaying of indicators and so on based on different sources, sightings, tags, and so on. And this is coming from an initial implementation test and so on. So we have kind of a constant stream of advanced features in MISP that we integrate coming from academic idea, experimental idea that we have, and those ones are going back into MISP. And if we think it's not really useful, we just throw it away and we go for the next thing. So we are not afraid of rewriting things and so on. And on a yearly basis, we organize a MISP summit, so usually it's a physical meeting, but last year we did one, it's still available on YouTube, where different users are presenting what they are doing. So you have, for example, organizations that are creating software like WHIDS, which is an ADR, an open source one, where they show the integration with MISP. You had people from McAfee showing what they do and what kind of integrations. You have people from VMware too showing what they are doing. You see other open source project integrations, how they integrate into MISP. So the MISP Summit is really for users that really show off what they are doing with the platform, so they are extending their own tool to support the platform. So going back to the different problems that you might have when doing sharings and so on, you have something to keep in mind, and that's, I think, quite important. When you share information, don't assume by default what will be the use case of the one receiving the information. And that's really important because depending on that, the quality of information might be different and so on. And there are obviously at least three different models that we have seen in different sharing communities. Obviously, the first one, and this one is, I would say, the most common model for an incident response team, so CSIRT, a CERT, or a SOC, is really the detections. So it's basically, as a CERT, for example, I will create an event in MISP with some attributes, some object, and so on, telling and explaining that I have some indicators of compromise, some information about tactics of the attackers. And if you use those indicators, you can make some kind of detections, either for the techniques, either for the indicator, whatever. But it's just detection, so that means you don't inject it to block, and that's usually one of the issues that you can have. Some detection rules are obviously creating false positives. And that's why when you share information, never assume that everyone is doing just detections. Some people might use the data to block things like firewalls, proxies, things like that. So in MISP, you can really, for example, give a confidence level, give a level of false potential false positive rate, and things like that. And this will really help you to define what things you can do with the data. And that's really important, and you can just like specify that in MISP. We have different models. We will talk about it during the use case, about IDS flag and so on, but that's really important. And sometimes you have even people that are using MISP for having low quality data, where they really want to have the raw data to do analysis. It's very common for research projects, academia. It's even common for some SOC where they want to qualify the different sources, they still need the raw data. So those three kind of use cases where people are consuming data and using it might be conflictual at some point in time. So just keep that in mind, but it's something to keep in mind when you are sharing. And when you use MISP to share this information, you have basically some features that help you to avoid an impact on the other end when reusing the data into automatic system. So MISP is a software. You have plenty of communities that are actively using MISP. So for example, FIRST is one. At Circle, we are operating different communities. For example, we are operating communities for the financial sectors, for the private sectors, different specific ones for very specific financial groups and so on. But there are plenty of other groups and communities. So if you want to join one of the existing groups, you can get in touch with Circle. But on MISP itself, you have already a list of known groups. It's not an exhaustive list. It's giving you a kind of idea of the communities using MISP. But that's giving some interesting information about, okay, where I could join, in which field I am in, and so on, and you can join it. And you have really different kind of communities. You have, for example, what you call trusted group. Those ones are usually private clubs where people are sharing information in different things. And usually those are kind of air gap system and so on. Nevertheless, you have more that are like sectorial basis, and you have like financials one, you have a specific one in I don't know, retails, all industries, and so on. You have other that are more focusing on intelligence and so on, which are completely disconnected, for example, or even from other MISP communities that are maybe gathering information, but are really very sensitive or classified, and then they use MISP there. Then you have specific security vendors running MISP too, and you have even not sectorial one, but what we call topical communities. For example, we run a MISP for COVID-19, but you have plenty of other MISP that are topical. I know some that are on a specific threat actors or on a specific kind of things, like, for example, collecting phishing kits and phishing groups and doing correlation on that. So that's basically the communities. We'll talk later on about how to build your communities, but it's super important. MISP is just a software basically supporting the communities. Now, not everything is, I would say, nice and cool. You might have some difficulties for sharing. Obviously, one is not really linked to the tools itself, but it's more linked to, I would say, the social interactions. And this one, is quite important and serious. It's really the one that is, I think, need the much work. The rest is like easy to solve. Because this one is really a human problem, a human group. I mean, FIRST is doing a tremendous job on that. I mean, they are doing events, connecting people and supporting people on that, and basically building trust with social interactions. And that's the thing. If you want to build a community, for the one that we have seen, the most successful one are the one having strong social interactions, people knowing well each other, and so on. So it's really bringing trust and creating really nice community there. Nevertheless, you have always the same kind of recurring questions for information sharing, especially about legal restriction and so on. And for me, we are quite well prepared on that because it's something that we work for the past years. And for example, the topic like GDPR, privacy rules, depending on which country you are and so on, or related to any privacy rules and so on, we basically document that. So if you go on the MISP project compliance part, you have a very nice report regarding GDPR, where you see that GDPR can even be seen as an enabler there. So that means the sharing of information security elements and indicators or trade intelligence is used as a way for improving privacy and so on. Because if you share information about attacks and so on, about leaks in advance, that means the victim could be notified early on. And that's super important for that. So that's why those local restrictions usually are just discussion about the legal framework and so on. But there's already a good framework, for example, in Europe. It's pretty strong regarding GDPR, and we know a lot of communities that are popping up and actively relying on GDPR. We have some functionality in MIS, like what we call the notice list, to notify analysts when they work on very sensitive data set, and that's going to be used by different organizations. Then you have plenty of practical restrictions. There's still a kind of misconceptions about what kind of information you could share. A lot of people think that sharing, it means that you share actual data, but sometimes it could be an observation itself. So for example, not the data itself, it could be, for example, the sightings, saying that this information is incorrect, for example, is an act of sharing. Even if not the information itself, it's really the fact that you share some details, and you have different models of sharing. Thing that we have seen too is MISP, if you are looking into the taxonomies, as we'll talk about it, is like huge database of plenty of classification scheme and so on, and that makes sense. A lot of organizations, sector of activities and so on, have their own classifications, and that's fine. But in MISP, we will try to be flexible. So if you work for NATO, for example, in the military sector, you might be very interested into the NATO classifications. No, nevertheless, if you're in a CCIRT, for a national CCIRT, and you have no interaction with NATO, for us, NATO classification doesn't make sense. So in MISP, you can just like, I want this classification, and I want, for example, the European classifications, and I want the NATO one, and so on. So you can really have your own classification, and that's really something that's coming from the users, asking us, okay, we want to make it flexible, and that's something that we can do. For example, one of the first classification we had, and first is using it, is the TLP classifications. Over the time, the TLP evolved, definition, and so on. So that's why we have these taxonomies that can be updated, maintained, and so on. And for example, the special interest group at first, dealing with TLP, can propose changes in this knowledge base. So we have kind of a really open knowledge base in MISP, where people can apply and propose their models to other communities that they are willing to just activate it on their list. Other thing that we are trying to do is we have a standard format. We'll talk about that later, but thing that is interesting, we try to be independent and flexible for the format. We know that formats are evolving, changing, and we don't want to be bound or stick to a specific version or specific format, because you might end up into troubles. So to just summarize a bit, what is a MISP project? So if you look back 10 years ago, it was like one single repository with a very simple software for just sharing indicators. Nowadays, it's a pretty large GitHub organization. We have more than 60 repositories there, and they are split in different parts. So we have kind of four pillars in MISP. Even if, depending on some project, it might be in different pillars, but like that, you know, we have basically the core open source software. So for example, when you use test MISP and so on, it's really the MISP core software. So it's a mix of PHP, Python, and so on. It's really the core software that you use, API, UIY, and so on. Then you have a series of different extensions, like the MISP modules. So it's more than 250 modules for MISP for doing like expansions, export, import. So if you want to quickly extend MISP, it's there. I mean, a lot of expansion modules are there, domain tools, gray nose, whatever you name it. You can just like look at the website of the MISP modules, and you have plenty of different ones there. As MISP has a pretty large API, so there's some kind of legacy API and a very advanced one on the REST part. To simplify the access, we even have a dedicated Python library, which is doing all the standardization on the API and the format itself. So you can really use Python to create your own event, structure the message, and so on, and pass it back to MISP, or not even passing back to MISP, but for example, to creating fields and so on. A lot of people are using it. It's really a nice library to ease your day-to-day work. And then you have plenty of other projects. I just pick one here. It's the MISP dashboard, which is an extension plugin on the 0MQ feeds of MISP getting real-time information and basically displaying into a nice dashboard. You'll see that MISP core system has a dashboard too that you can customize per user. We will do a quick demo of it today. So you can see that you can really do a lot of flexible things regarding monitoring. But the project itself is not only the software. And that's the other part. I mean, if you have a tip with no information inside, no knowledge base, nothing, it's barely useful. I mean, it's just information there that is just a system. But, and that's why in MISP, we have an extension, multiple extensions and knowledge base. I quickly talk just before about the taxonomies. So taxonomies are standardized formats for describing a specific tag classification and so on, but it's pretty large. We have classifications starting from TLP up to things like OSTNA evaluations, sources and so on, estimative language one. We have even one for the drugs, for example, used by border control. So it's not really our use case, but others are having such kind of use case. So in the document, MISP Fundamentals pad, you'll see a link below with all the references, with materials, taxonomies, and so on. So it's a good list, and you can just navigate into this page and see all those different taxonomies. When you have, I would say, more complex things to describe, not just like those tags, we have what we call galaxies. So galaxies are basically cluster of elements that are describing different kind of things. So maybe some of you are very familiar with MITRE ATT&CK. So it's a model to describe technique and procedures of and kill chain of the different attacks, techniques used by an attacker. So MITRE ATT&CK is basically map as a MISP galaxy, but you have plenty of others. So you can really create, for example, we maintain a pretty large one with all the thread actors, synonyms included, more confidence level information and so on. And this one is really a huge database of information that you can use in your MISP to attach and contextualize information. We have another one for the warning list. So it's a list of known things. It could be IP addresses, domain names, things like that. So to help the analyst to discover if there is false positive or information that are appearing from different different places.
We have a really good question.
Yeah.
So it's asking if MISP is free and will it stay free and if it is adequate for an enterprise.
Yeah, that's very good questions indeed. So there's even multiple questions in the questions. I'll start with the first one, and that's this one is, I would say, our kind of important mantra. MISP will be always free for various reasons, and one of the big reasons for that, it's we even choose the models where every contributor remains the contributor of their thing. So you basically lock the software into a license. So it's an open source license. Nowadays on the core systems, we have close to 400 contributors, and all contributors basically become part of the group. And when they contribute, they own a small part of MISP. And by doing that, it's impossible to change the license because you will need to have all the agreement of the different organizations and so on, which is nearly impossible. And we don't do any CLA and so on. So we do this kind of authorization for authors to contribute, but that's basically it. And then you remain authors too. So that's a very strong point. We have seen in the past, and we had some bad experience with some of the tools that appear to be open source at the beginning. Then an organization is behind, is signing CLA with contributors, and it happens to me, for example, so that's why I'm a bit upset on that aspect. You contribute back, and then one of the company decide, oh, we change the license, it's not more open source. So yes, we do everything possible in MISP to maintain it as an open source project and to have autonomy and independence on that. So for us, it's really a key point. Remaining a free software and open source software is super important. The second aspect that we're asked is it fine to use by companies and so on? Of course, yes, it is, for different reasons. So for MISP as a strong, I would say, foundations as an open source project, but various organizations are even providing professional services around MISP. So they basically use as a MISP as a background. So we have seen that MISP is, for example, bundled into some other software. For example, even us, we are providing some kind of professional services as Circle for various members that we work with. We do partnership on that and so on. And many organizations are using MISP. In the financial sector, one of, for example, main financial institutions doing financial transactions worldwide is using MISP. You have plenty of many organizations in the security sectors and so on actively using MISP. You have plenty of security providers and so on actively using the MISP format itself to share information. Did I forget something, Sam?
No.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. If there's more questions regarding licensing, open source and so on, don't hesitate. It's a topic that we love and we will be more than happy to discuss about it. Then going back to the slides, we are talking about the standard. That's going back to this point regarding enterprise readiness and so on. At the early beginning of MISP, MISP has its own format, and more organizations started to use it. But organizations wanted to have kind of stable and fixed formats, and that's another thing that is really important for the stability and the long-term approach and the viability of the project in the long term, is to ensure that the format itself remains stable. And that's the case. So we have something called MISP-standard.org. Maybe Sami can post in the chat, which is the organization. So it's kind of a top organization around MISP, which is hosting all different standards. This one is quite interesting because it's describing all the standards and the format that we have. And this one for us is quite important because we want to make it a kind of fixed format. So we extend it. So you have plenty of possible extensions. Excuse me. And this allow organization to basically keep a set of format to maintain and to basically use. And then we have a kind of extensions, things like object template and so on, where people can extend the format as they wish without impacting the core format. So for us, for usability and long-term integration and so on, it's very important. I think Sami shares with you the link of Miss Panda. So it's giving some kind of interesting list of current things that we are working on. And the standards are evolving. It's quite interesting because we are even participating to the Oasis CTI technical committee. So we actively work on the sticks aspect too, to be sure to properly map everything. But the MISP exchange format is like much more advanced for sharing outside cybersecurity. So things like intelligence. We know that people, for example, are using MISP for exchanging data for climate changes and stuff like that. So it's flexible, so you can really use it for different. And then at the same time in the project, we have this kind of four pillar, and the fourth pillar, which is about providing already actual data. So for example, we provide an OSINT feed, which is publicly available, that you can ingest into your MISP. It's not ingested by default. You just need to enable it into MISP, depending on what you want to do with your MISP instance. But it's quite useful because you have your feeds there. You have already example of feeds and so on. So it's building. And when you start a community, it's a good way to even bootstrap your community and see how others are describing information. And we do plenty of other things. I was mentioning about compliance document, about GDPR. We have a lot of training material. So in the pad, we share the completely the rules and materials, and we have plenty of additional document books and so on. So it's quite extensive. If you are missing something, just tell us and we can discuss about it. Then we have a last initiative, and this one is an important one that is growing. It's what we call Cross ISAC. It's an ISAC that we co-manage to be able and to at least support other ISAC using MISP to share information between different sectors of activities and so on. For us, it's quite important because sometimes you can share information in a kind of a silo, but you want to extend it. And that's a way to do it. And we even share kind of documentation of building your own ISAC, for example. Again, everything is open source, including the documentation and so on. So going back to the core functionality of MISP is sharing. And on one way, it's basically there are some idea that is obviously coming from the open source communities and so on, about sharing and so on. But I just want to start with a very important point. Sharing doesn't mean that you share with the external world. Sharing means that you can share with two parties, two people, So the act of sharing between two analysts. So for example, if I have a private MISP and only Sami and I are connected, we will use a MISP and we will start to share. So that means we can use any of the functionalities. So for example, we have the sharing groups where you can define who you want to share. If I just want to share with Sami, I will create a specific sharing group. And if I want just to share it with myself, I just create one with my own organizations or even a standalone sharing group with just myself inside. Not really useful, but you see the idea. Then you can extend it and go above that. So sharing is really depending of how you want to do it. And obviously, a lot of organizations, especially intelligence organizations, military organizations, are not really keen to share because it's part of their DNA. On the other hand, you have some organizations that want to share more advanced, extensively. First is a good example where you have a set of CCIRT where the sharing, but the sharing is still limited to the first member. So you really want to set or choose or fine-tune the sharing to whatever you like. And then we have the additional feature in this format. And one is what we call delegations. This one is pretty interesting. It came from the financial sector and banking sector in Luxembourg. You know that in Luxembourg, we have some banks, but sometimes banks are a bit, I would say, called to share information about incidents, things that they have seen and so on, because they might see things that other people, if bank names appear into kind of incident detections, that other people think that they were like targeted and so on. So we have a functionality in MISP called delegations. So it's allow an organization to delegate to a third party. So for example, if I work for a bank and Sami is working for a banking association, I can ask Sami in the banking association to publish the event under his name. So the nice thing with that is like kind of pseudonymizations. You still have the trust. Obviously, Sami from the banking sector activities associations would need to validate the data. But that's quite important there because you will still see the sharing, you still benefit from other people contributing back and so on, but you delegate it and it's not associated in any way to your name. And then you have additional one, you have proposal extended event. Proposal is, for example, you receive a report from an antivirus companies like I don't know, Kaspersky, McAfee, Symantec, whatever. You receive an event and you see in the event a small mistake. There's an IP there in Luxembourg, which is incorrect. You know it's incorrect. It's a typo. So you can propose a change to the original author of the event. That's what we call proposal. And you can just share such kind of information. In addition to that, we have what we call extended event, where it's a bit more advanced. You can create a new event starting from an existing event. We'll talk a bit about terminology about event, but basically an event is a container of information having the same semantic meanings. And the extended event is basically extending an existing event to add your for analysis, where you define exactly the sharing and so on. So it's super interesting there because the extended event is a way to do collaborative or competitive analysis. Again, I take the example of an antivirus company providing a report. This one is public and so on. But you, or at least your organizations, do not agree with the report. Obviously, maybe you don't want to share it back to the antivirus company for various reasons, but you still want to share it back with your community, your members, your team, or maybe two or three people in your organizations. And to do that, you can basically just extend the event, make your own analysis, and in MISP, you have a very flexible way of like merging those kind of two events and make it accessible to everyone. Another thing that is quite important in MISP and sharing, there is more than one way to share. There is not only, I would say, a point-to-point synchronizations. In MISP, it's pretty straightforward. If you want to connect to another MISP instance, you can just like connect, pull all the data, and that's it. Straightforward. It's, as long as you have an access to the other instance, you can do it. For example, if you're a first member, you can get an access to the MISP of first and pull the data back into your MISP without any problem. Obviously, following the rules of sharing, because it will be mapped on that, but it's straightforward. Nevertheless, there's plenty of other ways of sharing information. So we have the feed system, which is a way to share information not with a MISP, but with, for example, pure static files. So for security reasons, feed provider, things like that, it's super easy. Then we have plenty of other models like air gap sharing. And this one is very common in the military sector, for example, where they are completely air gapped between the two worlds, the internet and the others, but they still want to basically benefit from sharing. In MISP, you can do it. All the exchange can be done through synchronizations, but through air gap too. So you can use USB key, you can do temporary files, file DO, stuff like that. It works out of the box and you can do it. And you can even afterwards, so for example, if you start as an air gap system and then synchronize, same event will be synchronized properly and so on. So it's even compatible between the different sharing scheme. There's a filtering of sharing, which is obvious. I mean, if you want to share, you want to filter out. And you can really, in addition to all those kind of sharing mechanism, you can add additional filtering. So you can have like a very secure rule set if you are really afraid of sharing too much, for example, or if you really want to filter specific information that is shared and you have a specific process, for example, within your organizations to do the sharing. Another thing that is interesting too, this one came from another training that we had in, if I recall correctly, it was in Norway or in Iceland. I don't remember. I think it was in Iceland. So it was coming from some banks that they are willing to get information from other instances without pulling the data. So that means they would like to know if someone knows about something without having the full data set. And you can have that in MISP. When you pull data, you can do that with the first instance, for example, the MISP first instance. You select caching. You pull all the data, but those ones are just in a cache. So that means you can say when you create an event, oh, this attribute is on first, and then you can go for further information. So if you want to have a clean MISP with just your analysis and nothing else, that's a good way to do it. And then we have plenty of other models. I will not go into full details on that, but you can have like group of MISP within a single organization, so kind of enclave, what we call. So it's nice, for example, when you have a we do that as a cert, for example. We have a MISP where we have all our junk data, phishing, spear phishing, and so on going into, but we don't want to pollute our MISP with the analysis, and then we just connect those ones as being local organization and so on. So, and then you can play with the rules and so on. So it's quite straightforward there. But if you start to ingest data, you have to do information quality management, because this one is really an element, a key element for sharing back information, and sharing the quality of information meets certain criteria. But those criteria might be different. So we don't take for granted all the criteria from different organizations. They might change. I mean, people doing just research, they want raw data and so on. Maybe they don't want to have any filtering. Nevertheless, for others, they want to have additional tools. And in MISP, you have plenty of ways of looking at quality management. First is correlations. When you see correlations, it's only giving a lot of details about the information itself. An example, quick one. You have a malware. You start to do reversing of the malware. You extract IP addresses, indicators, HTTP string, data, and so on. You enter all the data, and then you see one single correlation, one of the IP. And you see like hundreds of correlations. You go there, you navigate, you see that it's indeed your malware and other malicious things. And we're like, Then you see that you have a small warning saying, oh, it's part of a sync call, IP addresses. So MISP will be able to tell you, oh, in addition to the correlations, this IP has been seen as a sync call too. So makes sense. When you have a malware that you analyze and, an organization already sync call the CNC infrastructures, you can see it automatically in MISP, because you see directly through the warning list and the correlation. So it's two functionalities that you can really actively use. Another thing that you can do too is the sightings. So for specific indicators, you can even cite it, say that you have seen it or not. Quick example, I'm pretty sure many of you have a CIEM, you have plenty of log analysis and so on. But sometimes you want to cite data that you have seen in your CIEM into MISP. So you can say, for example, if you have a specific IP address that you see, and this one is like super annoying and is scanning for SSH on your infrastructures, you just cite it and automatically it will be in MISP. So that means you can see as an analyst in MISP that this IP address is already known by us, cite it, and it can even change the lifetime of indicators and so on to the things. And that's another thing that is very interesting. A lot of those functionalities are interconnected between each other. So for example, if you apply sightings, then you benefit from a very accurate time of this validity of data and so on. And I'm sure Sami will show you some cool example of those kind of sightings reappearing, and then, oh, it's again there. Maybe we should refresh a lifetime of those indicators. It's really cool. And then we have, for the validation and so on, we have plenty of integrations. It's really interesting. A nice one, and this one is really good too, is the timeline functionalities. And maybe some of you already did some forensic analysis and report. It's super, super painful to do timelines because you have to collect all the information. So in MISP, you can do it automatically. So if you inject data with dates, time, and so on, automatically MISP will show you a very nice timeline that you can even reuse afterwards for your report. And it's a nice way to see if you have any gap or issue. For example, if you add a lot of attributes, indicators, and so on, and you mistype dates and so on, when you see a timeline and you see something like 2023, maybe in the future it makes no sense. So it's really something interesting to use. And you see that we have plenty of those functionality into MISP, but during the use case management and usage, so both of us will do some example. You see that you can really play with that. And that's applicable to any data. Cybersecurity indicators, intelligence, whatever indicator. So that's quite interesting. You have plenty of nice use cases there. So really to conclude on this introduction is really the practices of information is coming from usage, and that's really important. We have seen a lot of sharing communities that are, I would say, slow to start and so on. But it's because just people need to bootstrap the community and you need to add information and so on. Because a lot of people, including us, I mean, we are learning by imitations. We have seen, for example, some organizations starting with like sharing some information about phishing and so on. And then you have another group say, hey, you know that for this fish, you can download the fish kit in that way. And we use these techniques to extract this. And we were able to, you know, automatically blacklist it on the phishing website on that way and so on. And then you see the events are growing and growing with additional information. So really imitation is really helping you to see the level. I mean, I remember some years ago, MISP event usually have 2 or 3 tags. Nowadays, you have tags everywhere, contextualizations, Galaxy setup, and so on, with the threat actors and so on. So, I mean, the quality, for example, attack matrix is now used regularly, and it's very interesting for the practice. So you see that is really a practical usage. As I said, MISP itself is just a tool. I mean, don't expect the tool to do all the job for you, but I mean, the tool is there to help you to improve the sharing, and we try to be as transparent as possible. So we have plenty of ways to do things in MISP because people have different ways of working. Some people might, for example, work in their own systems. They want to have an API to MISP, some want to use MISP. Others are even using other type connected to MISP, for example. So we are super flexible on that. And that's, I think, important to support those different kind of way of working. And we don't want to put analysts or people in a box and force them to use a single technique because it usually doesn't work. And obviously, it's really an important thing for us. It's really to meet the community use case. So if you have any use case that you want to discuss even today, publicly, or if you don't want to discuss about your use case publicly, we can discuss this later offline or off the record. So just to conclude of what is the MISP project is really a combination of open source software, open standard, the different best practices, and a huge set of information, and especially the communities of people using it, which is, I think, very important for us. Is there any questions regarding the introductions and so on?
Next time, let me take the screen.
I'm checking the chat. If you, I see one Q&A. How do you report false positives? Is done by the community, the certification team. In the... Okay. So what I will do is I will answer. So Boris Bonin was asking a very good question. How do you report the false positive, and how is this done by the community or the dedicated team in MISP responsible to investigate them? False positives are obviously done by each of the communities, so it's depending of what you are doing. So each of the community, so in Isaac, for example, you might have people that are engaged in doing the false positive management. In some group, it's basically a collaborative approach where people are extending and sharing their way of reporting a false positive. So in for MISP itself, the software, we provide the tools. So one of the tools that we provide is the sightings. For example, we have a negative sightings for the false positive and so on. So it's really bound to your organization. So you have different ways of reporting a false positive. We will show some example today in the different use case. But it's not the tool itself that is responsible. It's we provide the different set of tools to do it. And then we can then use it in your different communities and so on. But looking at your questions, maybe it's interesting because you say that maybe it's like a kind of global database of false positive and so on. Usually what we use is a warning list. We don't have kind of active one for all different MISP communities sharing those kind of false positive. But that's something that we could do through a sighting database. There is an extension in MISP for doing sighting database. So that means it's using another one. As far as I know, there is not a public one. I think Sammy want to show us something.
Yeah, so this is what I like.
Now it should be better. Can anyone confirm? Okay, perfect. So it should be better. So if you want to go more in depth in how things are interlinked together, or to know more how we represent things, we also have this slide deck, which go in much more depth than this cheat sheet. So, all right. So just before starting the small exercise that we'll do together, I just want to mention three main data points that we use everywhere that is extremely important in MISP. In MISP is how we encode data, basically. So in MISP, we have three main ways to encode data. The first one is what we call event. So anything that happened in MISP, any data that you have in MISP, like for example, a file hash, an IP address, so on and so forth, they have to be contained inside, well, a container. So for example, if you have an incident that describes something bad that happened in your organization, you will create then an event with a quick summary of what it is all about. And in this event, you will describe what happened, what are the IOCs, and so on. So this event is basically the main container, the main envelope containing all the different data points that you will encode later on in MISP. And all of these data points, we are calling them attributes. So these are really, as described here, really basic building blocks to contain information. So any an IP address is an attribute, a file hash is an attribute, a text is an attribute. So really basic block of information. And then what you can also do with this basic block is to group them together with an entity where these group makes sense together. So for example, if you have a look at a file can have a name, a file can have a size, it can have a content, it can have multiple hashes, and all of these attributes can be composed into what we call a MISP object, which will describe a file. So another example would be, for example, a person. A person can have a name, first name, last name, and so on. And first name, last name will be an attribute, but when you group them together, it will form what we call a MISP object. So these are the three main data points that we use in MISP, and these are really the most important stuff. Okay, so now let's have a look at our small incident, our small fake incident. So this is what we'll try to encode. So basically what it is we received a fake email from our CERT in the telecommunication sector in Luxembourg. And we'll read it quickly just to see how it goes. So they say that they had a failed spear phishing attempt targeting their CEO. And then they provide some details. So what they say is that the CEO received an email. They give a time frame. Then it contained specific messages that mentioned the child of the CEO. Then the attacker pretended to be working for the school of the CEO's daughter. And the mail was sent from a spoof address, which is given here. And they also mentioned that John Doe, so the email address, is the actual teacher of the CEO's daughter, and that the email was received from a specific provider with additional details. Then it also said that the email contained an attachment, which was a malicious file. Then once it's executed, it tries to download a secondary payload from this location. We have more details. And then it says that this secondary payload is trying to exploit a CV. And after a brief triage, so they quickly analyzed the secondary payload and they saw that the CERT saw that there is an hard-coded C2 that tries to exfiltrate local credential to this location. And then as a notice, they say that this is currently analysis. This analysis is in progress, so they are not done. And they ask us to avoid informing the attacker that they detected that it was a failed spear phishing attempt. And so they ask you to only use the contain information to protect your constituent without performing search online or anything that would make the attacker think that his spear phishing has been detected. So this is rather complete, and we'll see how we can encode it in MISP. So we have set up a training instance. So if you want to do it or to play with it during this this small demo, feel free. The details to log in to this platform are given in the pad, but I will also post them in the chat so that it's easier for everyone. So this is the URL. And then I will also provide the credentials. There we go. So for the user account, you can pick whatever you want. So for example, you have training12 at misp.test. Just pick a random number, and the password is provided in the chat. OK, so let's see how we can encode it. So whenever you log in into MISP, this is what you will see. So this is the list of all events that your organization can currently see. So you can see that we have a bunch of stuff available. So you have the information of the event. You have some contextualization, such as tags. You have dates, who created the event, which organization created it, and which organization owns the event. But let's not focus too much on that. Let's encode our event directly. So first thing to do is to create an event. So to create an event, you click on Add Event. And then you are provided with this really simple interface asking you additional information about the event you are about to create. So quick event info. So this field is meant to give a really concise, small description of the event you are currently encoding. So in our case, we know that we are dealing with a failed spear phishing attempt in the telecommunication sector in Luxembourg. So we could describe all of that. So for example, you can see that I already typed it. But basically, it's just a really small and concise description of what we are talking about in this event. Distribution, all of that. Let's keep it as the default value. For now, we'll go back to that later on. All right, so we have created our event, and we can see that we have already a bunch of information that have been added by default. So to quickly go over them, we can see that the training organization, which is the organization and my user is part of, has been set to both owning the event and being the creator of the event. This is normal. Then we can see that we have a bunch of tags that have been added automatically. This is because this in MISP instance is configured that way. Every time you create an event, this tag will be applied automatically. And of course, you can remove them if you do not really agree with it. So for example, TLP White, this one I will remove because in the email, if you remember, they say that they don't want to inform too many people. And also that you should only use this this information to protect your constituency. So you don't really want to let everyone know about it. So let's remove it quickly. And this is not really OSIN, so I can remove them. I can keep this one. Then you can see right away that MISP is saying that it's missing a taxonomy. So this is also another configuration on the instance. We make it so that every event to be valid, they have to be at least one TLP tag from the TLP taxonomy. We will take care of it later on. So let's continue. Distribution, we'll see that later on. We have our information, that's fine. And then we have the attribute table, which is currently empty because we just created the event. We haven't added any information yet. So let's start and let's see what we can encode in the event. So it says that the CEO received an email on this specific date time, and it contained a personalized message. Then it provides information about a spoofed address. Okay, let's try by just taking something really simple, like, for example, this email address. And let's try to encode it. So the first thing that you can do is to create an attribute out of this. So to be able to have it register in your event, you can create it by clicking on the plus button. Then you end up in this interface where you can choose different things related to your attribute, but you can see that you have really a lot of controls of what you want to describe. So for the category of the attribute, what it is, you can choose from the list. Same for the type, you can choose from this list. So you have really a fine control of what you can do. But if you are a bit lazy, what you can also do is to use the tool that we call the free text parser tool. So I will take the sentence just to show you quickly. And it's the button next to the plus button. If you click on it, you can paste a text, and MISP will try to automatically detect any potential IOCs that you have and parse it and display it. And then you can then review it and save it if you are fine with it. So for example, this one, this email address was extracted from the document, and then the category and the type have been picked automatically. Obviously you can modify them if you want to, but let's say that you are fine with it. So let's submit. And that's it. We have created our email address. So let's continue. So we first stated that we have a mail. So what we could do is to create each individual attribute one by one regarding the mail. So for example, we would have the origin, the providers, and the different, for example, the date time. But what we can also do is create immediately an object. So instead of creating every attribute for it, we could also create an object. So to create an object, you have to go on the side panel, click on Add Object, and then you can pick the object. So we are looking for an email. So if you search for email, you will see that we have an email object. And then you end up in this interface, which shows you every available data point where you can encode things for an email. So for example, we have the subject, we have the message itself, the two BCCs, so on and so forth. For example, the from. So you can fill all of them. Unfortunately, we don't have the email that were received by the CEO, but we can still encode some stuff. For example, the from, we know that it was coming from this one. So we can encode it with the from. And we also, I'm just looking for something. No, I don't see it. But okay, let's say that we are fine with it. We don't have the headers. No, I don't think so. Email body, we don't have it either. Okay, let's say that we are fine with it. So you submit, then you have this review interface. You can create it. And there we go. Now we have our email object. Okay, so what it also says is that we have a person, which is the teacher of the CEO daughter, and that this one has been impersonated by the attacker. So what we can do is also describe this information. So we'll go into Add Object, and we will describe that a person has been impersonated. So we search for person. And for a person, we have a lot of stuff that can describe a person. For example, the last name, we saw it was Du. The first name was John. alias, we could also put an alias. We know that it's the teacher of CEO's daughter. We even have the email address. So for this one, we can once again copy it. We know that it's a mail, okay. So you can click on submit and you end up in this review interface. Everything seems to be okay. So you can create the object. And there we go. We have now a person in our event. So let's continue. We also know that the email was received from a specific provider. And so the CERT, the Delco CERT, gives us this information. So the IP here and the domain. So what we can do, for example, is to create a combination of these two by creating a domain IP object. So if we search for domain, we can see that we have domain crawl, that's not this, and domain IP, this is the one we want to encode with. So for domain, we can take the domain. Copy link. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's not really a link, it's the domain. And then the IP. Seems good. We can submit. There we go. So you can see that we really are starting to encode a lot of stuff. It starts to make sense. Let's continue to add all of these information, and then we'll start adding relationship between these entities. So now let's switch to the actual email. So it says that it contains a malicious file, which is attached, and this file would try to download a secondary payload. So the first malicious file is actually here, so I will just download it quickly. Oops, so malicious.exe. It's not really malicious, in fact, it's just a putty client. So to add an attachment, you also go in the sidebar, you click on add attachment. Then you can select, similar to the attribute interface, whenever you're adding an attribute, you can select the category of this attachment. For us, this malicious file is a payload. So let's take payload delivery. Let's select the file. So download. There we go, malicious. And then MISP is asking, is it a malware sample? So if you check this box, what it will do, it will encrypt this file and compute all the hashes. So if you are submitting a malware or a malicious file, always check this box so that if someone wants to download this attachment, it will not run automatically. So the file will be encrypted. They will have to decrypt it using the password infected. So this password. And then they will be able to see the file. So it's always good. And in addition to just encrypt it, you also compute all the hashes of this malware. So it's very good for correlations. Then you also have this advanced extraction. If you have the Leaf plugin installed, which is by default, if I'm not mistaken, it will also compute a lot of different stuff like the different PE section and their hash associated to it. So I will not check it so that we don't really pollute our event, so that we have really a simplistic view. But if you are actually encoding malware, it's always good to check it. So you can see now we have our file, the malware sample, the file name, the different hashes, everything has been computed automatically. Okay, so let's continue. So we have our file. We also know that this file tries to download the secondary payload from this location. So this is an URL. And we also have the IP it resolves to. So we can also encode it. So add object. We have an URL object. I can add it. The domain, I can also add it. Domain with OTLD, I can also do it. IP, we also have the IP. Oops. And does it have a port? No, it doesn't. I think it's fine. Okay, let's submit. Now we have our URL. Awesome. And then it says that it tries to exploit a CV. So just for the sake of it, let's encode it. So right now I'm adding an attribute manually, but again, what I could do is to be lazy, try it with it. And we can see that it automatically picked it up. So externalizes vulnerability, that's fine. So when you don't really know what is the type or what is the category, just use the free text tool. It's a quick win. And then we have the secondary payload that we could also encode. So let's download it. So it's cool, this is not malicious. We'll save it. Once again, I will add the attachment. So I go on the sidebar, add attachment. I pick the this is not malicious. I say that it is a malware sample, but I don't want the advanced extraction. I upload it. We have our secondary file. And we are almost done because we are arriving at the end of the mail. We also have this R-coded C2 with the URL and the IP address that we have to encode. And then that will be it for the data points. So, okay, so let's encode it. So copy link. So this is an URL once again. So add object, URL. We have the full URL. We have the domain with a tilde. And we have a port. And this is very important, you will see why. Yeah, that's it. I'm pretty happy with it. And now we have our last URL. Let's see if we have everything. Yeah, same so. Okay. So now what we can do is to start adding relationship between the different data that we have encoded so far. So you've seen that we have the person, email addresses, files, URLs, and so on. But now we want to describe in MISP how these data points are connected between each other. So if we look at the mail once again, the mail we received, it says that a mail was sent, a person was impersonated, and a mail was received from a provider. So what we could do is create references between these different entities. So there are two ways to do it in MISP. Either you click on this add reference button, and then you can choose the relationship type. So it can be, for example, if you are sending an email, you can use the send to email. So you have a list of verb, and then you have to select a target. But this is not really convenient, especially if you have many attributes or many objects. We have a better way to do it, is to do it actually visually using the event graph functionality. So if you click on the event graph, you end up in this interface, which shows a graph of your event. So right now we don't have any references created. So you can see that you have some attributes that have no reference and that you have some objects that they don't have reference either. So let's create these. So we know that an email was sent from this provider. Oops. So we have, I just want to check which provider it is. It's throwaway email provider. Okay. So we have this provider and we have this email. So what we can do is to click on add reference. Oh. And then select the relationship type to be, no, it's not sent to, it's sent by actually. So we can see that I'm missing a keyword. So there are two ways to circumvent the missing keyword. The first one is to have a look at what already exists. So to try other verbs. So for example, let's see if we have received. No. Do we have a sent by? No, we don't. Sometimes it's also good to try the relation the other way around. So instead of send, it could be received and so on. But in that case, we don't have it. So what can we do? We can use a special relationship type called custom that allows you to set a custom verb. So in our case, so the throwaway email, so the provider is sending this mail. So I could do like actually the other way around, send by. Or so I could do send by this way, or I could do this one is sending the email. So, and I think sent, we have it. Yes, we have. So click on submit, and then you have your collection, which is created. Okay, so let's see what else we have. We have this person, which is impersonated by this email address. So what we can do is to create the relation and says that this email address impersonates this person. Perfect. So what else do we have? We have this one. We can also describe that this the first malicious payload is contained inside the email. So the first malicious payload was malicious, I think. Yes, it is malicious. So edit, add reference, email, and contain. And you could see that I could do it the other way around. Like I drew an arrow from the mail to the file, and I said that it's contained, but I could also do it the other way around, like from the file to the email, and I could pick contained by or contained within. Mm-hmm. That's great. Let's continue. Then we know that this file was downloading a secondary payload. So we could say that. So file one, file two, downloads, downloaded from, downloads. So we've seen that we have the downloaded from relationship, and so we can do it. So it was, this is not malicious, from the evil provider. So this one, downloaded from. And then the last one is the hard-coded C2, which received the exfiltrated credentials. So I could say that this file, so the secondary payload, is actually exfiltrating data to this server. Exfiltrates to, that's perfect. Okay, seems pretty good. So let's see what we have remaining. We have two attributes remaining. We have the original email source that we enter at the beginning, which is also represented here. So we can just leave it be. And we have the vulnerability. And for the vulnerability, the telco assessor told us that it is the thisisnotmalicious.exe file that is trying to exploit this vulnerability. So we can also encode this. So the thisisnotmalicious file, and we can say that it uses or exploit. Exploit is maybe better. Very good. So we have now a nice graph explaining the story that we just had. Everything is described. So what we can also do is to quickly rearrange it so that it's easier for anyone that would want to read it to quickly have a look at it. So we have our first one, the sending, the impersonation, the first file, the second file, and then the exfiltration. This one is exploiting this vulnerability, and it was downloaded from this location. Okay, so let's say that we are happy with how things are organized. We can also now save it. Save one. You can save it. And now, next time you end up in this event and you are viewing this event that you want to see this graph, you can also restore the state of the graph by clicking on this button. So just to illustrate that, I will reload the page, go into the event graph. So you can see that everything is disorganized and you can quickly reload it by clicking the button. Oops. Oh, I was a bit too fast, apparently. Still have this one that is still here. Oops. There we go. And now it's restored. So I will not go in depth in what you can do with this graph, but basically you can have multiple scopes, so you can pivot on different things if you don't want to pivot on references. You can play a bit with the physics. You have various display feature, filtering, and also different exports. So if you want to export it into PNG or DOT or language or JSON, you can do it right away from the graph. Okay, so I think it's covering a lot of features regarding the data point. But one thing that we are still missing is the contextualization. So far we only created data, but we haven't, for example, specified what you can do with the data, how you can use it, what is it all about. So let's do that. So first thing first, we can see that we are missing a taxonomy, the TLP. So let's add a TLP tag. So to add a TLP tag, you click on this small button with a globe on it. And then you have a list of all the taxonomies that are enabled in this instance. If you don't really know, if you know the tag name, but you don't know in which taxonomy it belongs to, you can click on all tag. But in our case, we know that we are looking for a TLP tag. So the TLP is the taxonomy is called the TLP taxonomy. So we can click on it and then we can see the different tags. So let's pick TLP Ember. So in the email, the telco cert also asks us to be mindful that this is an ongoing investigation and that they would like to avoid informing the attacker of the detection and kindly ask you to only use the contact information to protect your constituents. This can also be described using a tag belonging to the PAP taxonomy. So the PAP taxonomy is a very good taxonomy, similar a bit like TLP, but in regard in what you can do with the data itself. So for example, PAP white, if we look at the description of this tag, it says that no restriction in using this information, so you can basically do whatever you want with it. If you look, for example, for TAP red, it says non-detectable action only. So you cannot do active research, you cannot do searches on Google, you cannot do research on your network and so on. Nothing that can be detectable from the outside, basically. And then you have some intermediaries. I invite you to read them. But for our case, we know that the CISO specifically asked us not to perform anything that could inform the attacker that they've detected it's a fail attack. So we'll use the PP red for now. Okay, so this is great. What we can also specify is what kind of event it is, what kind of attack we are talking about. So we also describe it in the title, but this is not really automatable. So if you want to filter out, if you want to automate extraction and so on, you don't want to do parsing of free text that you can have in an event title. So we'll use a tag to describe what we are talking about in this case. So we know that this is a spear phishing. So we can also attach a tag which could belong to a spear phishing taxonomy if you have one. So in that case, I don't remember which taxonomy it is. So we have a phishing one. So maybe it's this one. So it's an email spoofing. Yes. What else do we have? It's a spear phishing. And we also have a bunch of others of the state, if it's active, down, psychological acceptability. So very good stuff. We'll not use it right now. But it's worth investing time to getting used to all of these taxonomy that you might use. So let's add this. What else did we have in our mail? Okay, so I think for taxonomy it's enough. Now we can move to continue the contextualization, but now rely on galaxies. So just to give a quick difference between the three type of contextualization that we have in MISP, and for that I will use the cheat sheet. That would be nice. So let me get my cheat sheet back. Taxonomy, galaxy cluster. Okay. Up. So in MISP, we have three ways to contextualize, I think. The first one is with tags that you've seen. So a tag is basically just a label with a color that you can add. So by tag, it can be basically anything. So for example, ransomware, docx-c2, basically whatever you want. But if you want everyone to understand it and everyone to speak the same language, and basically have a standardized set of vocabularies, all of this tag can be expressed in what we call a taxonomy. So it's basically just a list of known vocabularies that you can use. Such taxonomies, for example, the TLP. So you can see that we have a bunch of different TLP tags, but some of them belong to the TLP taxonomy. So if you look, for example, at this one, this is the list of, I would say, the official TLP tags that you can use, because these tags belong to a taxonomy. So you have tags, tags belonging to a taxonomy, that's the second one. And the last one, and the most complex one, I would say, is what we call galaxy and galaxy clusters. So what galaxy clusters are, they're basically also tags belonging to taxonomy, so tag belonging to a standardized set of vocabulary, but they also carry additional meta information. So let's have a look at such a galaxy. For example, let's take the country galaxy. So you will see what I mean by additional metadata. So we have a country. So let's take Luxembourg, for example. So it could be a tag belonging to a taxonomy where you would have just, for example, a tag name would be country colon Luxembourg. But if you use a galaxy, you can add meta information to this tag. For example, you can add the capital, the TLD, the language spoken, the population, the currency, and so on and so forth. So a galaxy is also a standardized set of vocabulary, but they also carry much more information. It's like an encyclopedia. For example, another galaxy could be the Tradactor one. So if we look at the Tradactor, if we take APT-29. You have a small description of this Tradactor. And then you have a lot of meta information, such as the suspected victims, the target category, so which kind of target this Tradactor is targeting, type of incident, some references, and then a bunch of synonyms. Because Tradactor can have different synonyms depending on the vendor and so on. And so it's not really easy to figure out which one you should use. And so this is also a thing that the galaxy cluster are trying to tackle as a difficulty. If you contextualize your event with one specific Tradactor, it will inherit all of the synonyms so that whenever you do a search against MISP, If you search, for example, for Cozy Beer, you will also get back all the events that are tagged with APT29 because it's part of, it contains the synonym. Okay, so now let's add these galaxies. So let's go back to our event. And let's add a galaxy. So we know that we are talking about an incident that happened in the telecommunication sector in Luxembourg. So let's add the easiest one first. So all namespace, yes. And then sector. And let's see if we have a telecommunication. We have telecom, this is fine. Now let's also add the country. And then we know that it's in Luxembourg. And so now you can see that we have these information here. And if you hover over them, you have some more information. So that's also something that is quite nice. You can also pivot over these galaxies. So if you want to for example, view all the events that are tagged with this galaxy, so that have the Luxembourg country associated to the event, you can click on this, and then it will show you all the events that contain this information. You can also have view more information about this cluster, so it will pivot you to It will pivot to the galaxy cluster view, where you can see more information about this cluster. So we've added a sector, we've added a country. Now let's add something that is very important. And I think nowadays everyone is talking about, and it is the MITRE ATT&CK pattern at Trix. So MISP fully supports it. So to have it, you can select own namespace or just the MITRE ATT&CK one. And then you have this button. Instead of going into all cluster, you can click on the attack pattern, and what it will do, it will show you the MITRE ATT&CK matrix, which is very similar to the one that is hosted by the MITRE, by MITRE. And what we have is we want to describe a spear phishing. So you could either search in the initial access to search for phishing and spear phishing, and click on them, or you can also use the drop down here and start typing, for example, for phishing. So I will take this one, phishing, and then spear phishing attachment to submit. And then I have my attack pattern. Okay, so we've contextualized our event, but what we can also do is to contextualize the individual attributes. So if you remember, in our emails, we have one particular attribute. So this one, so this URL is actually an R-coded C2. So we can also describe that this is a C2. So it is another evil provider. So let's find it. Another evil provider is here. We can add a tag and also say that this is a C2. Thread type, we could take thread type C2 from this taxonomy, malware variety C2, a backdoor. You can see that we have a bunch of stuff. Let's just, I don't know, let's use this one. Okay, so I think we've encoded everything. Now there is one last thing that I want to go over is the different fields that we haven't really talked about, such as the correlation field and the two IDS field. So when you are creating an attribute, I will edit one so that it's easier. So for example, let's edit the CV one. when you're editing an attribute or even creating one, if you remember, you have to select a category, a type, you have the attribute value. But then we have two options that we haven't talked about, which is the for intrusion detection system flag and the disable correlation flag. So for an intrusion detection system flag, if you check it, it means that it's basically an IOC and that this IOC should be blocked. So it's really meant for automation. So if you connect MISP to, for example, a SIEM or an IDS, basically every attribute that have these flags turned on will be exported. And it should be understood by the tool that this attribute should be blocked, basically. And the disable correlation, it's, well, if you want to disable correlation for this specific attribute, but we'll see correlation in a minute. So to go back to the intrusion detection system, let's review what we have currently for the different attributes that we have. So for example, this evil provider, we can see that the IDS flag is checked. This is perfectly fine. So that means that this URL should be blocked by any tool. And it absolutely makes sense. I mean, we can immediately see that it's an URL that is malicious with a very high port. So the chances are high that we have that we should actually block it. So this is fine. Then for the domain, this domain is clearly malicious also, so we can also have it. A domain with all TLD, we could have it too. For the port, now this is a very specific and very high port. And moreover, we know that this port is actually hard-coded in the malware. So chances are that this port is used for doing only malicious activity. So in that case, it makes sense to also specify that this port should be blocked by your intrusion detection tools and your intrusion prevention tools. Now let's continue. We have the file, we have the payload. This should be blocked. The file name, however, this one, not sure if it's really relevant, especially that usually we'll not have a file name that appears that's like malicious.exe. It will rather be like, I don't know, notepad.exe. And you don't want to block anything that is called notepad.exe because user will not be able to use that application anymore. So for a file name, usually it doesn't make sense to enable the IDS flag. However, for these file hashes, it makes a lot of sense because they are unique and computed from the malware sample itself. So it makes sense to have this checked. Size doesn't make sense to have the size to be blocked. Same discussion for the secondary payload. For the email address now, this is somewhat debatable. It's up to you. So either you decide that any emails coming from this email address should be blocked. If you think that it's the case, you can enable it. But in our case, this email address was spoofed. And if you have the actual John Doe with his own email address want to send an email, well, it's absolutely legitimate, so it doesn't really make sense to block it. So it's up to your interpretation and what you want to do with it. In our case, as we want to protect the telco constituency, we can consider that it's just a spoof address. It's not the address in itself. It's not harmful. It's rather the content that is harmful. So we set the content to be blocked, but not the email address. So I will uncheck it. This one was the provider, the malicious provider. In our case, we consider it that is a malicious one. So we keep the IDS flag. CV doesn't matter. For the URL, same thing. And then for the person, well, we're just describing a person. So now we review our IDS flag. Now let's see if we have a correlation, if it makes sense to correlate on some of these endpoints. So if we go back to the top of the event, you can see all the related events, meaning all the correlation that we have between this event and other events that have at least one attribute in common. So we can see that we have a bunch of them. So we could either pivot between the different events. So if we click on one, we can see that it's actually the same event that was encoded in previously. So we can see it was encoded like 2 weeks ago. And we can see that it contains at least one of the attributes between the two events. if you want to have a graph out of all of this correlation, you can click on the View Correlation Graph button on the side menu. And it will show you a graph containing all the events and the attribute that they have in common. So we can see that we have a bunch of events. So let's try to. So you can see that we have a small cluster of attributes here in the center, and all of these attributes are contained also in all of these events. But we also see that we have some others. Attribute in common, some galaxies that are in common. And if you wish to continue exploring this graph, so for example, you are here, you want to pivot on this Luxembourg galaxy cluster, you can also press the button X to expand this cluster, and it will download all other events that are tagged with this galaxy cluster Luxembourg. And I think I just did a mistake by trying to expand it because it seems that we have a lot of content. Or maybe not. That's because these are already classified correctly. So that's fine. Okay. So this, interesting. So I was logged out. Mm-hmm. Let's log in again quickly. So let's just see if we can now pivot and expand. So it was a galaxy. PP red galaxy, yes, this one. Oops, you can see that some other event appeared. Let's take, for example, the Luxembourg one, oops. So you can see that you can continue and explore this graph. Okay. So let's review every field that are currently correlating in our event. So for example, this email address is doing a correlation. So this is fine, we can let it. It could be also worth it to enable correlation for this high port number. If we had a lower port, like, I don't know, 80 or port 443, I would not recommend to enable correlation for that one because you will have a lot of basically useless correlation. Same remark for the IDS flag. I mean, you don't want to block any port with 80 or 443 because that will just disrupt your network. And then you could do correlation on the file name. This is not malicious. This is a very particular file name. So you can do correlation on this file name. But if it was something like notepad.exe, maybe the correlation is not really that helpful. Obviously, for the hashes, it makes sense. Yeah, it's basically the same remark as for the IDS flag, unless perhaps for the vulnerability, so the CV, you probably want to have a view of other events that where they contain malware that are trying to exploit this vulnerability. So in that case, we have the correlation flag checked, but not the two IDS flag checked. Okay. I think that's it. I think we've covered almost everything. Do you see anything else that we could add?
Yeah, I see something else maybe that would be interesting would be the expansions, so the MISP modules. And for CV, it's interesting there because the CV itself is like not super useful for an analyst. Nevertheless, if you have a lot of detail about description and so on, you can do the expansions. On the training instance of MISP, you have multiple modules activated, including one for expansion through one of the services, public services with CV expansions. So if you go over, you see you have a nice graphical interface to give you some details. But sometimes you want to do a bit more. So it's as an analyst, it's like a supportive tool. But you have this kind of explosion button there. When you click on it, it will propose to use one of the modules. And we will pick the CV advanced module because this one is giving more information. And then you can review it. You have a list of the different things there. Which are, for example, in this case, the CPE, the associated description, and so on. Then you can select which object you want and so on. And if you just select and say, okay, it will be imported into the events as the additional informations with all the details that you collected and so on. So it's really useful for expansions when you have to discriminate and so on. There's enrichment, automatic enrichment on the global event too. So you go on the left side, you have the enrichment there. And then you can select which module you want, and you do the enrichment automatically. It will be done in the background. And so if you don't want to do it manually, you can do it automatically. You can even trigger it from a script, things like that. So it's pretty cool for an analyst. There are a lot of modules. On the training instance, we just enable some modules where we don't need any API keys. But if you have API key for various totals, any other services that you might have and so on, you can just enable it and you basically have access. You see that the graph itself has been updated. So the MISP modules is creating an object with relationship and so on. So what Sami showed to you, you can create it manually or through the event graph view. You can do it from external modules. In this case, it's this specific modules. So it's quite interesting. So this example is really, I would say, cybersecurity example where you have a thread and so on. Sami showed to you how to inject it or update it either through the, I would say, normal standardized interface of setting up attributes, the free text import, combining different attributes together to make an object. I think you show it. That's quite interesting because there you can, if you don't know at the early beginning, you can have a kind of stack of attributes and things like that. And then more you get more information because you work more in the analysis, then you can go a bit further. Just before the break, because we have a small break of 15 minutes before, what I will propose to do is to just show you an example of how to do it with a non-cybersecurity example to see that it's really flexible. You can really do whatever you like. With this, I will take back the screen maybe. And if there's any question and so on, don't hesitate to basically shout in the chat directly or in the Q&A of the Zoom. Okay, so what I will show to you, it's basically another strategy of creations, but just to show you the versatility of MISP and what you can create. So again, and I think Sami did a great introduction of all the data model and so on. So the cheat sheet that he saw, it's really a key element to have next to your computers. It's really giving you the overhead of the data models of MISP. Again, so we create an event there, so which for my own organizations, thread level, we don't exactly know and it's ongoing investigations. But in this case, I see that I use it as a kind of citing of someone. So seeing someone suspicious in the surrounding. So just to show you that you can really play a lot of with MISP and so on. So we know many use cases of people using MISP for different things, but there we might have something like, okay, I've seen someone which looks suspicious and we want to basically document it and so on. So again, I can go for object, creating an object, starting with a person. So the person I've seen is this guy is there. I can add another one, which is so this guy obviously looks like Clint Eastwood, so we don't exactly know who is it. So first, last name. So you can, again, it's depending of your use case, but in this case, we have seen the Clint Eastwood or Dirty Harry close to your buildings. Sounds a bit suspicious. What you can do, for example, and that's quite interesting. You see that I add multiple portrait and so on, so you can really add anything you want to the object multiple time and so on. You see that it's quite useful for the graph later on. If I take the case of Clint Eastwood, I can create this one. I can have an alias in this case. It's we know that it's called he's called Dirty Harry. What is his role? We can say it was basically witness. As a policeman, usually you're witness even if you use a gun. Then you put the gender, male, for example. Then again, you can create the object like Sammy show to you. You see that we have some correlation. So you can even have correlation on image, attachment, and stuff like that. So in MISP, so it's pretty cool. So you can even see that we have already some activities in another city in France about the same kind of actors, only one, but not the other one. So if we know more about the guys, we can, for example, add things like his vehicle. So if we know his car, we can create a vehicle. We can say it's basically a car. We can attach maybe a pictures of his car. What kind of car it is? Good question. So it's a Plymouth, I think. Oops. I don't know if Plymouth is done by Ford or Plymouth, we don't care. So I'm just creating this kind of object then. So again, I have two objects. Sami showed to you how to create easily a relationship between those two objects. We see that we have here the persons, we have basically the car. Again, so you see, it's not at all cybersecurity, obviously. We just link persons to the car. We can say that he's the owner of this car and have relationship between the different cars. And you can basically do that with everything that you have here. Things regarding relationship and so on, Sami showed to you two options. Either you cherry pick from an existing list of relationship, or you create your own relationship. Usually we advise to have to use the common relationship. Obviously, you can create your own. But the nice thing with that is if you want to automate on the graph model and so on in MISP, it's better to have the same vocabulary for the relationship. But again, it's a matter of test. Sometimes you don't want to play with that. And again, you can add additional informations, either contextual. In the case of attack, you have a specific matrix and stuff like that. But you can create and add additional ones. So for example, we have a pretty advanced one, for example, for financial frauds, maybe. Where is it? Oops. Yeah, okay. We can use attack for fraud. And then we know that this guy was doing ITM skimming, ATM black box attacks, and doing obviously cryptocurrency exchange. So yeah, you see this guy is super suspicious. He's doing already a lot of activities, but again, your galaxies and so on is not really bound to cybersecurity. You can really create your own with additional informations and context that is really helping what you are doing on a day-to-day basis. So it's just to show you that you can really create whatever you like. The object itself, we won't talk too much about it today, but those ones are basically templates. So if you want to extend MISP with your custom object and custom data, you can automatically do it. It's super easy to do. If you can open a text editor and edit JSON files, you can do it. We have a set of existing object templates for the majority of I would say, common use case. You see that you have already a lot of those. But if you want to add an additional one, you can just create one. So for example, in this case, if we go back to our case, I can again create an Interpol notice. And for example, we can say that this one is red. Again, I have a nice portrait of Dirty Harry, and I can say that that's basically it. And again, you can start to create again a story behind about the Interpol notice, the person, the associated person, and so on. And again, this Interpol notice was a contribution from a third party that wanted to have this kind of notice in MISP, and is an object template. So you can really create your own object template. So again, MISP itself is super versatile. You can really create whatever you like regarding object model and so on, relationship. If you want to create an additional object template, you can do it. And the thing is, they are still valid even on MISP instances that doesn't know about the template, because it's carry on with all the data during the exchange of the messages with MISP, and then other instances, even if they don't know about the template, you get the informations. So like that, you can keep kind of, you know, relationship with third parties, start to share information, so they don't need to update their MISP or to update their object template and so on. They will receive the information and be able to parse it. So in addition to that, and just to show some example, in the PAD document, we have some example from the trainings. I will just talk about one before the break, which is interesting. It's a case that we handle, and it's coming from a long story there, but I will just make it short to just show that what you can do with such kind of MISP event, and or what kind of thing that you can analyze and describe. It's about spear phishing. So we discover an interesting attacker, which is basically doing something, I would say, very simple. He's sending out PDF to targets, and those PDF contain an image, and this image, a box with a kind of image, and this image contain login interface to Office 365, a specific cloud provider, and so on. But it's worked quite well. When we start to analyze it, we were like, okay, how can we track such kind of activities? Because the thing is, we just received one or two messages from potential victims or target, and they were wondering, okay, what do you know about the attacker? So when we started to dig into it, we discovered that this attacker is always using the same size of box in the PDF document. So in this case, you see that we were able to create a YARA rules, and you see that it's basically, if you have a rectangle of that exact size in a PDF document, this one is most probably one of the phishing done by those guys, which is quite interesting because we started to investigate the case, and we were running this YARA rule on VirusTotal. So you see, in this event, we started to collect more and more information. The first thing that we were able to connect is a Gmail account, which was linked to the adversaries, and using that one for sending out credentials and so on. We even discovered the kind of fake, or at least what he's trying to fake, especially specific cloud provider and so on from different targets. In this case, we see, for example, he was trying to target Airbus, Lenovo, and other companies there. So for us, it was even very interesting because we were able to gather from those initial PDF documents based on a simple rectangle all those target URLs. Then we started to improve our rule because the thing is, we discovered that the target author was using a tools, and the tools was always containing GAT. So it was interesting for us. So we were starting to basically collect those. And we were able to obviously extract one of the phishing websites that he was running out, and extracting even the complete script he was using. So it's pretty straightforward. Was using PHP, sending email automatically. So he was using that for sending email to that email addresses. We had a lot of targeting information. So who is targeting? We discover additional things. We discover even some specific sample, the PDF document themselves, the VirusTotal report for all the files that we found. We discover specific targets. And then we started to basically draw a specific map of an attacker. So we even know the guys because he was using a GAT boss everywhere. So we just created a person with a suspect. And again, we were collecting more additional files and so on over the times. We even were able to extract the phishing kit on those websites. And the thing that is interesting there is when you read the specific event graph, you can directly see the complete story behind. My internet, I was just logged out. Okay, no worries. So what kind of story we have here? It's basically the specific attacker itself, so the persons, and we can automatically see, okay, the course of actions, who is targeting, from which evidences that we have this targeted from, and so on. So you see that those kind of graph view is not really a gadget. It's really something that is really useful to have a quick look at it, analyze it, and view it. Same for the event timeline. If we want to see the timeline of events, we automatically see it in MISP. So that means for every single time it's set, we see it. In this case, we don't see the one that we have collected. What we are seeing is what we encode it, which is even interesting there, because we indeed started at 12 on 16th of May by just creating the Yara rules. And already in the afternoon, we were able to collect the information and so on and get all those details and so on. Obviously, you can zoom in, zoom out of in all those timeline. It's really interesting. You have plenty of options. You can even look at the specific attribute and so on. You can even change the time scope if it's first seen, last seen, if we had sightings around it, and things like that. So that's an example. If you're curious, we have four other examples there. We might go into some today and after the break to show you some of the features using of the example of MISP. But you see that it's again, you have a versatility of creation of MISP event there, which is quite nice. And we can show you some very more advanced one. For example, I did work on structure one for the original Syrian Electronic Army activities. And there we have the complete attack. They did against the New York Times, where you see who is the target, what they did, and you have the complete timeline of the period when they were active and so on. So which is quite interesting there, because you see when from passive DNS record what you have seen and so on. So again, the tool is generic. You can really create additional things, but it's really there to help the analyst to work on a day-to-day basis. Okay, so what we will do is 15-minute breaks. So we will start at 30, again, I would say. And then we will continue on sharing aspects, collaborations, and so on using MISP. So see you in 15 minutes. Thank you.
Okay, so to come back to our topic, so every event and basically any data that you have in MISP belongs to one organization. And this organization is the one that sets who can view the data, so to whom it is visible to, and how this data should be shared in a specific instance, but also in all connected instances to this one. Okay, so now that you know that, we can go into what is available for us in regard to the distribution. So which distribution level we have access to. So if we go back to our event creation, you remember we skipped it. We have multiple levels of distribution. You have your organization only, this community only, connected communities, all communities, and the sharing group. And I have a nice graph that shows how things should work. Okay, this is this one. So your organization only means that only your organization can see it. Regardless of your instance. So if you create an event on your MISP instance and you set its distribution to be your organization only, that means only your organization can view this event. Now, if you take the next one, which is this community only, this means, as you can see on this graph, that only this community, so by community, I mean only this MISP instance, because a MISP instance is in fact a community, only this MISP instance is able to view the data. So that means all organizations having an account on the MISP instance, we'll be able to view the data. So if you have, for example, the Twitch organization that you can see here, if it has an event set to the distribution level, this community, it means that these three organizations can also view this event. Obviously, only the Twitch organization can create data for this event, so only this organization can create attributes, can edit them. But this event and all its data will be visible to all of the organization having an account on this instance. Now for the next distribution level, we have the connected communities. So this one means obviously your organization, all organization having an account on the MISP instance, but also all MISP instances connected to your MISP instance. So you can see we have this box that shows that these two, so the gray, the red, and the orange MISP instances are connected. And an event created with the connected community distribution level will be able to flow from the gray MISP instance to both the red and the orange one. And once it arrives in these instances, it will not propagate further, and only organization having an account on these two MISP instances will be able to see it. The next distribution level is all communities. And that means you can see it with the dashed rectangle. You can see that it's, again, the same scenario. So it's the gray one. It's the connected MISP instances, but it's also the green one and the purple one. So it's basically all communities means basically it's all MISP instances connected to the network of connected MISP instances. So as far as an event can propagate in the network of connected MISP instances. So if you take all communities and you create it on the gray instance, every MISP instance is connected, even multiple hopes away, will get this data. However, it doesn't mean that it will be public on the internet. So if, for example, we have another MISP instance, for example, our MISP community that is running somewhere, if you have no link between ours and the diagram show here, we will never receive the data. So all communities mean in the network of connected MISP instances, but not the internet. And the last one, and this is a rather special case, it's called the sharing group. And it's basically a distribution list where you enumerate all organizations that that can have access to this event. So for example, we have a sharing group called a group of trusted partners working on the incident 1234. If we have a look at this distribution, if you have a look at this sharing group, we'll see a list of organizations that can have access to this event. And only these organizations can view it. So let's have a quick look at what it looks like. So Global Action List Sharing Group. Let's take this one. So we can see that these organizations, so Training, Citizen Lab, USAGOV, and Eurola, these one can view the event, and only these ones. So that means that you can also restrict which organization on a specific instance can see the event. Okay, so now that you are familiar with the distribution level, let's see where you can apply this distribution level. So let's go back to our MISP instance. Let's go back to our event that we created before the break. So the failed spear phishing attempt. So you can see the distributions level is set to your organization only for this event. We could also change it. You can also switch it from org only to, for example, this community only. But you can also set this distribution level to other data points, like, for example, object. If we edit an object, for example, you can see that we have distribution, the distribution field, and we can pick between your only, community only, connected communities, all communities, sharing group, and a special one, inherit event. So this basically means the distribution setting of this object will inherit the distribution setting of the event. And we have also the same for attributes. So they can inherit, but they can also be set to a different value. So the the nice thing of having this granularity when you can choose different distribution setting for different endpoints, well, data points, sorry, is that you can be really precise with what you want to share with partners, with what you want to share and what you want to be visible to also the organization. So if you remember this this nice failed spear phishing attempt that we had before the break, we had some technical information such as the vulnerability, file hashes, email addresses, and so on. But you have one really sensitive information that you are not really willing to share with partners, which is the impersonated person. So for example, our John Doe, the teacher of the CEO daughter. And so for this specific object, what we want to have is to actually restrict it, restrict its distribution so that it's only visible to us, first of all, and that it will not be shared with partners. So you can see that now the distribution setting of this object is your organization only, meaning that if another organization is previewing this event, if they can, obviously, right now they can't because the distribution is set to organization only, but if we change it to a greater distribution level, they will be able to see all the technical details aside from this person object as its distribution is more restrictive. And we can also be more precise with each individual attribute. So if we wanted to have this person object to be shared, but not his, for example, the alias, we could also do it and change the distribution setting of only this specific attribute. So we can see that it works with object and it can also work with bare attributes. So you really have this control over what you are able to let the organization see and what you want to be synchronized with other MISP instances. Okay, so that's for the distribution levels. Now, what about contribution? So how can you say that something is wrong? Or for example, if you notice a typo somewhere, for example, a port number has contained a typo, or a port number, for example, 443 is marked with the IDS flag set to on, and you want to turn it off. How do you propose changes to data you receive in your system? To do so, we have a system that we call proposals, and it basically allows you to do all of these. So you can see we have a small bubble icon that allows us to propose edits to data. So let's take, for example, let's take, let's take the person object. And let's say that, for example, we have the gender is not really known. So what we can do is to propose an edit. We click on this small bubble icon. Then we end up in the interface, really similar to the attribute creation interface, where we can modify the value. And so, for example, let's say, for example, female, doesn't really matter. Then we propose it. And what you can see, if we have a specific highlight saying that we have a proposal currently in our event and that we are this proposal wants to change the value of this attribute from male to female. We could also do it for other fields like the IDS flag or the correlation flag. So this is visible to the owner of the event, and the owner of the event is also able to choose between two actions. So he can either accept this proposal. And so if he accepts it, the value from the proposal will be, the value of the attribute will be replaced by the value of the proposal. Or he can choose to discard it. So let's choose to accept it. And you can see that now the attribute value has switched from male to female. Okay, so this is for collaboration. So we can edit you can edit attributes and then it will turn into a proposal. But Something else that you can also do is, and Alex already mentioned it, is to do delegation of event. So you've encoded your event as a bank, and let's say that you are part of a bank association, to take the similar example that Alex used previously, and you want to, you encoded your incident, but you don't want to reveal that you had this incident in your organization. So what you can do is to delegate the technical information and the event to the banking association so that they will publish it under their name, and any reference to your organization will be like removed from the event. And so to do so, we have this delegate publishing feature available. So just a side note, this is only available if the distribution level is set to your organization only. Because if you have another distribution level, so for example, if you have this community only, that means every other organization are able to view this event and doesn't really make sense to do the delegation. But yeah, so right now we are under your organization only, and we can delegate the publishing. So let's click on delegate publishing. And then you can see, you can pick which organization should receive the delegation proposal. So in our case, let's say that the training organization wants to delegate the proposal to the circle organization. And then they can also indicate which distribution level they want to set for the event that will be taken over by circle. So in our case, we can say, okay, we only want this event to be under the this community only distribution level. And then you can add a small message. Hi, circle, please accept this delegation. Then you click on yes. And then you have a delegation request that appear on the event, and circle will be notified that they have a delegation to be accepted or discarded. And then circle can view this event, view the request detail, and they can choose to accept or discard it. So if circle accepts it, the event will be transferred over circle, and so circle will become the creator of the event and the owner of the event. So that circle, we have complete control over it, and no tie can be made between the original creator of the event and the actual event. Or circle can choose to discard it for whatever reason. Okay. So now that you've seen how you can create data, how you can collaborate, let's see how you can actually say to the community that an event is ready, and how you can actually synchronize this event over to other MISP instances. So this process is called publishing. So you can see right now that the publish the publish state is set to no, so meaning that this event is not published yet. So let's say that we want to publish this event to our constituency. So first, let's edit this event and change the distribution level to this community only so that they will be able to see it. Because publishing an event with your organization only doesn't really make sense, synchronization-wise at least, because, it will never be synchronized. I was logged out again. This is sensitive, very picky with the logging. But I mean, it's a training instance, so it's expected. Okay, so let's edit and let's put it like, for example, connected communities, so that right now this event can be shared one level away from the original MISP, if you have synchronization link, of course. Okay, so connected communities, and now we can publish. So to publish an event, we have two options. We have the publish event and the publish no email. So whenever you publish an event, a lot of background action are happening behind the scene. So first, it will switch the publish flag from no to true. So basically, just check it. It will also send email to people that are subscribed to the MISP mailing so that they will receive notification that a new event has been published. and it will start the synchronization process with all MISP instances connected to this one. So if you publish it, but let's do the full chain. So let's publish it. So it says that the job has been queued. And if you wait a bit, that the background worker picks the job up and then process it, and we reload the page. We can see that now the event is published. We have the date. And now this event is accessible to everyone and has been synchronized with other MISP instances. Let's say that later on you realize, oh, but I accepted this proposal, but it's not true. John Doe is not really a female. It's a male. So you create a modification in your event. What will happen is your event will be marked as unpublished because you need to publish the change once again so that the change that you've performed locally can be propagated. So now what you can do is to choose between, again, these two, publish event or publish no email. But in that case, you don't really want to spam other organization and other users with an email saying that, okay, this event has been published because it has been already published once. So what you can do is to just do a publish no email, and that will only synchronize and propagate the changes without spamming the users with no mails, with mails, sorry. So let's publish with no email. And there we go. We have it published. So one last action that happened in the background that I forgot to mention is the ZMQ channel. So whenever you publish, you will synchronize, you will send mail, you will turn the publish flag on, but you will also write to publish subscribe channel everything that is happening on MISP. So MISP support to, how is it called? Data broker. So it supports ZMQ and Kafka currently. So if you publish an event, it will also send all of this information to a ZMQ channel. So why are we doing that? Well, it's because you can automate a lot of stuff. So for example, if you have a custom script that subscribes to this MQ channel and detect that this event is marked with, for example, a specific tag, and you want to create additional processing or additional queries and enrich it automatically, that you can do it quite easily with this MQ channel. So it's a way to have data that, and basically any event that are happening in MISP in real time, and that can be processed by script or external tools to perform actions. So that's why we have it. So if you want to also quickly send the event to the ZMQ channel without going through the whole publishing process, you can click on publish event to ZMQ, and it will publish only on ZMQ. Okay. One last note regarding data deletion and data retention. So in MISP, we have per se no data retention. Anything that arrives in your instance is saved and stay there basically forever, unless you take actions. So if you have a connection with our instance for the private sector called MISPRIV, you will see that we have very old event dating from 2012 and maybe even older. These events, whenever you start full synchronization, you will receive them, and they will be kept in the instance because we do not remove data automatically. This is first point. Second point is, what about deletion? So let's say that you've created an attribute. So for example, this one, this email source, John Doe, if you remember, we also created an object out of it. So let's have a look at the event graph quickly. So if you remember, we have this email, but you also have a duplication of this email address. And so let's say that you decide that you don't want to have this attribute anymore and you want to delete it. You can do it by clicking on this small trash can, and it will soft delete the attribute. So let's do it. And you can see that it disappeared from the table. So you cannot see it again. But actually, this attribute wasn't removed from the database. And for the simple reason that you want to propagate this deletion to other connected MISP instances. So what actually happened is you just by deleting it, by deleting an attribute, you will actually turn a deletion flag on so that it will not appear in the interface anymore. But you can still see it if you click on this small deleted button. It will show you the attribute that is marked as being deleted. And you can choose between two other actions to restore it so that you get it back, or to permanently delete it. Now, if you permanently delete data, this deletion will not be propagated. That means that if you instead of doing the soft deletion, you would permanently delete it, it will be deleted on your instance, but not on the connected instances. So now you may be wondering, okay, what happened if, for example, I share critical or very sensitive information about my company? How can I revoke this data on remote instances? Well, it's very tough. It's like a mail. If you send a mail to someone, there is no way for you to revoke the data that you sent at the first place. However, MISP still have some, well, it has some mitigation that can more or less obfuscate the data when a deletion is being synchronized. However, remote instances, they have their own database, they have their own logging mechanism, so they will always be able to find it back. But at least user on the instance will not see the deleted data, only administrator can see it. This is just a side note. So if I were a bit too fast about it, don't hesitate to ask the question or to ask me later on or after the session or event next time. But yeah, so deletion, we have mechanism to kind of obfuscate data if you overshare, basically. But usually it's really something that do not happen. Yeah, I think I've covered it all regarding collaboration and distribution and synchronization. So for all administration aspects, such as setting up synchronization links with other MISP instances, we'll see that at the end of the session, if we have time. So Alex, are you ready to take over?
Yeah, sure. Maybe I have to log in, log out.
Okay. If you want to do it with my laptop, it's fine.
Yeah. So it looks like I have the same issue as Sami, so I cannot share my screen, right? Stop sharing. Okay, just give a try again. Okay, so I need to log out. Okay. Small issue. Okay, so what I wanted to do, and that's in link with what Sami just did regarding sharing and so on, which is, I think, one of the key aspects of MISP is when you start to share, you are building communities and you are exchanging information with others and so on. So what I wanted to do is to explain what we do at Circle with MISP, especially on the aspect of sharing. What are, I think, our use case with MISP? So like that, you can even cherry pick maybe some of the examples that we are doing on a day-to-day basis for your specific use case and so on. And then I will talk on more generic use case that we had seen and especially best practices in a way to run your information sharing community, especially things that might be of interest to make it smooth, making active, and people are actively sharing information there. So the thing is, at Circle, we operate a different range of services as a CCIRT, and we basically use MISP and operational tools to cover our day-to-day activities. So we are not only the development behind, but we are one of the largest consumers and users of the different MISP packages and software. And what we have seen is we have a lot of different communities which have different needs and restrictions and so on. So we have to cope with that. And that's why we integrate that. So just to make a quick summary of kind of community that we are operating, Sami mentioned it, we are operating a pretty large private sector community where I think it's not up to date, but we have more than 1,500 organizations, which is acting as a kind of central hub for sharing things. This one is an interesting model because we operate that community for a very long time. And what we have seen, this one has a very, I would say, lax rule regarding the initial onboarding on the community. So that means we use it as a kind of default fallback. So if we know the organization, it's well known, it's part of the security community, can be a first member or others and things like that, you can join that community. But we operate, I would say, more restricted, tighter community. For example, the CCIRT community, which is the one for the CERT, for example, national CCIRT. So we, for example, cooperate one for the CCIRT network, which is a pan-European network of CCIRT under the NIS regulations. We operate that that community where basically the rules are pretty strict because it's bound to a law and a regulations in at European level. So it's a different kind of models. But nevertheless, between those kind of communities, you have sharing of information. So even if the community is a bit tighter than the others, it doesn't mean and restrict you to share information. It's just that the onboarding of users might be with different rule set and so on. Same with some other community that we're operating. For example, we operate some for the financial sector, where the sharing is there not related to cybersecurity, more to financial frauds, information like that. So for example, we have community where people are actively sharing mule accounts, so those kind of accounts used by attackers to do cash out. They are exchanging some specific information or vulnerabilities about specific tools, equipment, and so on used in banking system, for example, ATM vulnerability, things like that. But it's really focusing on the financial sector, so it's really sectorial one. So we cooperate, we co-manage and one called Cross Isaac. So this one is a cross-sectorial and cross-geographical ISACs, where our goal is to be able to bridge between those different things. So we have dedicated MISP community for that, and people can even use the data there to bootstrap their own ISAC. So it's really the idea that if you start from the early beginning, you need to have some data. And with cross-ISACs, we provide such kind of things. Another thing that we cooperate on and that we co-manage is the attacker view community, because this one is really important for us to improve the quality of information shared in MISP. I mean, contextualization is really key. And the attack model is really one nice way to describe a kill chain, the technique used by the attackers and so on. So we try to bring that on board through the attack community in Europe. It's really a nice way to standardized TTP and so on. And I think after the 2 or 3 years of operating it, we are quite happy to see that a lot of organizations are sharing actively MISP even and so on with attack model techniques and so on. And I think Sami showed it to you, it's really simple. You have a matrix and you can select techniques and so on. So that's really the thing. Then we have some other that we cooperate or maintain and so on. You have communities that are really bound to a specific sector of activity or specialized community, for example, the telecom sector, which, for example, have specific rules of sharing or specific kind of data sets. So, for example, if you look at mobile operators, they have the same kind of technology set like SS7 switches, things like that. and they want to have their own object for that, sharing this kind of information in their network. So we cooperate with them for that. And often in those kind of communities, they are creating their own taxonomies or even domain-specific object definitions. So could be like in the tech sector. For example, we have a good example. It's similar to ATTAC. It's called the BADRA framework. It's coming, I think, from one of the Nordic mobile operators, and they define really the attack step of and the technique step of an attacker in MISP, and so like that you can reuse it when you are sharing this community. As maybe some of you are already familiar with it, first org is operating a MISP, but there's a MISP community, an active one. If you're first members, you can just connect to it, and that's basically it. And we have plenty of other communities that we co-manage and so on, especially even for exercise. So sometimes people are setting up a MISP for a specific one. For example, in Lockshield, which is a NATO exercise, MISP is actively used during the exercise. So there are different scenarios of using MISP, and especially for sharing. And what I want to show you and to a bit structure the thing is to split in different categories how we, as a CSIRT, MISP can play a role. And if you know the RFC about the CSIRT, you know that usually it's like split into core services, proactive services, advanced services, and more generic, I would say, collaboration aspect with the CSIRT at large. And for the core services, we, for example, use actively MISP for various things. And things that is interesting for us is to use MISP for as internal storage. So we can store incident response data. Even if we don't share with others, we keep it for ourselves, but it's a way to do correlation and so on with external event, especially data that are gathered at various places and so on. So it's really, really important there. A lot of things that we are able to do too is when we do incident response, we are collecting a lot of information, techniques, intelligence about the adversaries, up to low-level things like indicators and so on. You can derive that. And for us, it's a nice way to, I would say, summarize and be able to do reporting about that. And I think Sami will talk about it. We have this event report functionality where from structured information, you can generate a report, which is usually a gain of time when you're working in a CSIRT and reports are needed and required for some incident response. Obviously, something that we were missing in many ticketing systems and so on is the correlations. As we are using it MISP, we can just directly use it as a way of correlating and finding out if we are already working on a case that we already work on, like for the past 5 months or whatever. Obviously, with MISP, we have this kind of MISP module functionalities where you can do enrichment. And it's really helping us to get more context if it's something that is known and so on. And the enrichment for us is straightforward to use in MISP, so that's why we are directly using it. Another thing that is, I think, interesting in the collateral effect of using MISP is collaboration during incident response. So if you have more and more users starting to use your MISP instance or a MISP in NISAC and so on, Sami showed to you a very nice overview of the different sharing mechanism or to share information and so on. But when you start with user in a MISP, you can really start to do the incident response within the MISP instance. So instead of waiting until that everything is done, you start to share early in the MISP instance before to have like, you know, cleanup report and so on. And we have seen a kind of trend nowadays where incident responders are sharing much more in advance and too late because, you know, indicators are expired or useless, or the adversary already changed techniques and so on. So it's really interesting to see that proactive collaborations and active collaboration during incident response is usually more successful than doing a report and sharing a bit too late. We are using MISP as a takedown request model too. So we have even a document about it, but it's a way, for example, what we have seen a lot of event share in MISP sometimes ISPs, cloud provider, and so on are not notified about issues in their infrastructures. So what we do, for example, we do automatic notification of takedown on specific event that we receive. So like that, we can automate the complete chain from the receive on an event with an incident up to notifying, for example, a cloud provider hosting a phishing website. We have a tight integration with the L framework and the L project. So it's another project that we maintain with about information. If you are curious, you can have a look at that one. But we have a tight integration with MISP. So that means, for example, if we find a credit card's number allocated to a specific bank, we can automatically generate a MISP event out of the information that we found, for example, on the Pestis website or on the forum on Tor and stuff like that. So for us, it's really one of the core services is really to integrate the full chain together and so on. And it's not in the slide, but we are working on another project called Cerebrate, which is supporting the orchestrations of different MISP instances and other tools. It's again open source too, but it's allowing us to completely support the chain, including the directory of organizations, constituents, and partners that we need to reach out. Then we have some kind of proactive services in the CSIRT. So where do MISP could help and support is obviously contextualizations. I mean, if you start to get like information and so on, better you contextualize it, better you know what you are in front of, and better you can react to it. Another thing that we are using it to is we are, for example, providing OSINT feeds or private feeds, and it's done through MISP. So that means we do the analysis and so on, and then we specifically tag the information to produce what we call a MISP feed, which can be integrated in another MISP and so on. So we use it as a way to disseminate our production of OSINT report and reporting from incident response. Another thing that we do sometimes is we do some kind of manual research and so on. We did a presentation at first CTI some months ago about tracking down botnets. And we're basically using MISP as a way to correlate and share the information about the botnet activities and so on. So it's really interesting there. You can use it for that. Another way to do it is really to use a MISP as a kind of, I would say, in a polite way, kind of a junkyard. So it's basically you are putting all your information from different places and you hope that you might have some interesting things there coming out of it, which is pretty useful. So for example, at Circle, we do that. We have a MISP dedicated to all those phishing activities and so on. So it's a lot of emails, junks, and so on. But at the end, we start to find correlations. And with the caching functionality of MISP, so when you connect to another MISP and you start to have caching, we can find correlation between campaigns and things like that. So it's really, really, really interesting. We have other things that are interesting too is maybe some of you are familiar with all those mailing lists for security. So you receive emails, things like that from different partners, but you need to re-encode it automatically. We show to use the free text import, so you can import free text, but we have even an API for it. And one of the tools that we developed called Mail2MISP is actively getting emails from different models. And then parsing it, passing in free text and creating events out of it. So like that you can add, for example, mailing list to MISP for your security analysis. It's really handy and we do that on a day-to-day basis. Additional things, and this one is a kind of, I would say, generic topic that is always talked about, is about situational awareness. So how is the different situation in your country, in your constituent, and so on. So you can do a lot of things with MISP. We didn't show today the dashboard, but maybe we'll have a quick look at the dashboard afterwards. But we have another functionality called MISP Dashboard, which is an external tool. And this one is consuming MISP 0MQ that Sami mentioned, which is a pub/sub channel where you get all the information from your MISP. So it's real-time information, basically. And we use it to generate some additional report and things like that. For example, this MISP dashboard is connected to a MISP there. What you can see there, it's basically all the attributes coming in. We do automatic geolocations, lookup and so on. And you can see the trend overall of those kind of things, including tags, where we have seen it and so on. It's really handy when you are in a team, you want to see what's going on, especially if you start to have a MISP with a lot of events coming in and so on. It's a quick way to find, okay, this kind of target or even attack model is basically increasing, or this kind of sources is producing much more information. Maybe I should have a look there. Another thing that we do, and that's something that is interesting, is what we call advanced services as a CSIRT. So for example, we do supporting of some forensic analysis, but the collections of evidences and so on is a tedious task. So sometimes we collect all the detail about the outgoing investigation, and especially the specific collection aspect of those evidences in MISP itself. So you can really use it as a way to do pre-incident response, which is basically the collection of evidence and just before the analysis. So you can go in that way with it. Another thing is sometimes law enforcement want to collaborate with CSIRT, and it's a nice way when the law enforcement is using MISP too, that you can already push them informations, or you can even provide caching to them so that they can find correlations in their outgoing investigation and so on. We have seen different use cases with MISP, but this one is quite interesting. It's about vulnerability. Sometimes those vulnerabilities are under embargo, not share, and so on. Sometimes you want to coordinate with vendors for notifications. So we have seen a lot of communities using MISP as a kind of vulnerability information sharing, where they share pre-notification, things like that. It's quite interesting there. For example, what we have seen is organizations sharing internal pen test report with the vendors through MISP, so like that they can acknowledge vulnerabilities, fix those, and so on, and using the functionality of collaborations directly in MISP. There are plenty of other things that, for example, in Europe, we have the NIS directive, and there's a collaboration between the CSIRT themselves that are in the NIS directive with the authorities or the authority that are in charge of the NIS directive. And sometimes you have to do legal reporting. And if you have organizations having to do legal reporting on one side, doing actual incident response and so on, it starts to be very cumbersome for them. We have some experimental and we engage into some research regarding that, where MISP itself is used for generating reporting while you can at the same time use it for your incident response with exactly the same data. So it's a way to share information. Another thing that is interesting when you start to use MISP is to engage in collaborations. We have seen a lot of communities that are where people start to share information and you see others that are replying, answering, and so on, because, oh, there's an interest for that. We have seen that in some cases recently, like FluBot and so on, where a set of mobile operators start to share information and they were like engaging in the collaboration because they were like starting to share information. Another thing that is quite useful and I would say underused nowadays is a request for help. It's the capabilities when you connect to a MISP instance, start to share events and so on, is to describe a really a pre-case and pre-investigation. So you basically request for help. And I've seen some successful incident response there by just using this kind of approach, because if you have a large community of people, like FIRST, for example, if someone is like, oh, I've seen this, do you know this? And then you have maybe one of the CSIRT answering, oh, yes, we know this kind of actors, we know this kind of threat, and we are working on it, and they can share additional information. Another thing it's something that Sami showed to you is about delegations. He showed to you the delegations of events, which is pretty nice. And those pseudonymizations really is pushing communities to drive the sharing. And then if you build a process of sharing and so on, you start to see limitations. And a lot of, for example, object template that we receive were based on an initial discussion about communities sharing additional information and so on. So it's an interesting approach there. Regarding compliance, I mentioned this at the beginning of the session of today. We have a Circle repository with compliance. So all the documents that we produce are open source too. So if you need to have some legal document or you need a start template for doing GDPR and MISP, just have a look at this repository and you can get access to it. So the thing is, a lot of sharing of information is quite interesting, because a lot of sharing it takes place into a sector of activities, specific geography and so on. But the problem is, when you start to do that, you basically segregates information between multiple groups, but you don't know if the adversary itself is really sharing that. So what we have seen is a lot of cross-sectorial sharing could really be beneficial. For example, a lot of actors are reusing TTPs, techniques, tools, and so on. If you know a tool in one sector and you don't know in the other sectors, it might be interesting for you. We have seen, for example, a lot of infrastructure reused for, I don't know, scamming, things like that, which has been reused for completely different threads. Another thing that we have seen is a lot of incidents on Autodesk, what we call hybrid threads. If you look at CEO fraud could be social engineering, but it's sometimes combined with malware, remote access tools, and things like that. So hybrid threads is interesting to describe, and especially to share this kind of information between sectors. Another thing is when you have one sector sharing and showing the culture of sharing, the others start to do it. We have seen that in some sector of activities. They work aside on it, and then they see, oh, they are doing it. So we have seen, for example, a sector like oils and chemicals doing it, and then you see the others in the other industrial sector say, oh, we want to do it too. And it makes sense. And obviously, when you share information, it's basically spreading the capabilities of sharing among the others. And as attackers are sharing, it's always beneficial. And I've seen a lot of countermeasures against attacks, for example, even basic stuff like DDoS attack or DDoS ransom, for example. If one of the victims share with the other, they know what the other are doing, how to behave with the attacker, with the adversary, and so on. And if you just look, you stay in your silo, you basically don't know exactly how the other are reacting and so on. So if you do that, you coordinate your response basically to the attacker. It's applicable for ransomware too. Sharing early such kind of information is very interesting, especially in cross-sector of activities. So another thing is maybe some of you are willing to say, okay, it's good, we have MISP, the tool sounds great, it's open source, it's simple to use, we have plenty of functionalities, but we want to start the communities. Then it's a bit more work, I would say, than just installing the tools. It's at the same time, it's quite easy, but it can be sometimes difficult too, especially that the moving part in such kind of discussion is the diversity of the group. You have different people, and I think it's applicable for Europe, it's applicable for the Arab regions, for Africa and others. You have a diversity of group, cultural groups, economical groups, and so on. So that's usually it's quite difficult to bridge some communities, not due to those technical limitations, but mainly to cultural limitations between the group. And what we try to do is that people can build their own communities by understanding how their community are set up. So the nice thing is when you start a community from scratch, you basically have all the power in hand. You can do whatever you like to basically start your communities and set the best practices. So we have seen some communities that were starting like super low, but they were like increasing their capabilities and so on, and especially what they were sharing because someone was setting the best practices. Could be one of the founder organizations, could be a specific partners and so on. So it's really, really important. So the thing is, if you run a MISP and you start an ISAC, you have plenty of different models. And I mean, if you are a user, you can become a member of an existing community. You can connect to a specific group hosting their own MISP instance. You can connect to a MISP instance from a CCIRT. So as a constituent, you have these different kind of models. But very often, for example, people start by just connecting to the web interface. I mean, what you did today by connecting to the training instance, accessing it, doing some tests and so on is one way of using MISP. It's like you don't have the instance, it's operated by someone else and you connect to this instance. But then it's starting to be interesting to host your own instance for synchronizations, things like that, filtering out these synchronizations. It's quite important. Another thing that you can do is become a member of a sectorial MISP. For example, the first.org MISP is one, and then you can connect. Now, if you want to host-specific MISP, there are some interesting things if you want to build a community from scratch. And I can tell you a little story about a community in Germany. So at the early beginning and the first meeting, we have seen a kind of frictions between some members that they were willing to share a lot of information, basically nearly everything they receive, honeypot information, things from targeted attacks and so on. And you had kind of user that said, no, I don't want those kind of, you know, raw data and so on. I just want this really high level targeted attacks and I don't want the rest, which is fine. I mean, they have different needs and so on. So, and this group in Germany came with a very good idea. Instead of trying to find a set of common ground, they said that, okay, share whatever you like and so on. But the main rules is to set a vocabularies by default. And that's very interesting because they set the rules by, if, for example, you have very like low-level quality information, you just set a tag there. And the other end, which is not interested by such kind of information, they just can't filter out these informations and focus on the one that is high level. So if you start sharing communities, maybe one of the first things that you have to look into is what kind of vocabularies can I use, so taxonomies, galaxies, in MISP, to basically allow various people to share, but to add context. So like that, the other people acting, organization acting as a receiver, can't filter out the data. So if you start one community, and we have seen some that were failing due to that, you have an organization with a secretariat. They say, okay, there is a MISP. There is no data there. Start to share. If you don't have any example of how to share, what kind to share, and so on, it will not know it start. What I have seen is a lot of communities that are sharing very early at the beginning and start to structure what they are doing are more successful than the one that won the perfect event initially. Because what you see, it's people are organically improving how they are adding more and more information into things. So really the improving aspect is really important. So another thing that is important when you build a community is not to blame people. What we have seen is you have someone sharing information, which is maybe interesting, and then you have someone in the group just blaming it, and you should not share that and so on, which is like basically just killing at the early beginning your project of sharing. So you have to really drive and support even people doing mistakes. So that means you can support them, explain what the information should look like, how it should be contextualized, what kind of consider being useful or not. And if you still, the usefulness of information might be different between organizations due to capabilities and some stuff like that, ask for at least contextualizations. If you have contextualizations, you know that the information can be used for specific activities. And if you don't like it, you just discard it. So really one of the things that is interesting is really raising the capabilities of your constituent. I have a specific case and it happens really again recently. We had a very annoying malware and it was quite difficult to extract the configuration from memory. So either with Ghidra and so on, it's not like something that you can easily automate. So some people were sharing information, but like not that much. But one day, one of the members started to share not the result, but the tools, because in MISP you have a specific object for sharing tools that you are using for analysis and so on. And by sharing that, you see that a lot of people increase their capabilities to extract that, and plenty of MISP events with that configuration and so on were shared because now they were able to do it. So it's really an interesting side effect. If you describe in a MISP event how you do it, it's basically giving you the key to make additional contributions. So another question is like, what kind of things could you share? What are the informations and how it should be structured and so on? So I think there's kind of misconceptions for the early beginning of sharing. A lot of people say, yeah, I just want to share, you know, this perfect report. Like, yeah, it's nice if you are sharing the result, it's great and so on, but sometimes it's too late already. The validity and the lifetime of specific information might be like weeks or even days sometimes. If you share the result very slowly and so on, okay, it's an archival interesting case, but okay, you can share reports in MISP, that's great. But you can go a bit further. So you can already share the pre-result, thing that you already do. You can even share, for example, extensions, expansion of the specific data and so on, really sharing the enhancement that you did to existing data. For example, the extended event is one way of doing it. We have seen some community where people were not really actively sharing data itself, but the validation of data. So flagging for false positive and so on. It's really interesting. So the sharing itself can be very different, have different shape. So what we usually recommend is embrace all of them. I mean, all those different ways of sharing are interesting, and they are not overlapping, but they are helping each other when you are missing some specific information. Another thing, this one is kind of a topic that we have heard for years. Sometimes people like complain, they have a sharing communities, and oh, we have all those people just leeching. But on the other hand, it's great. People leeching are actual users of the platforms. They are using it. And even in very, very active community, and I mean, if you look at First Smith and so on, it's below 30% of people contributing directly, which is fine. Look at Wikipedia contributions. I think it's below 0.01% for the article, but everyone is reading it. At the end, the knowledge of reading it was really useful. And it's the same with a sharing community using MISP. People are just sharing information that they can reuse. And if they reuse information to secure the network, at the end, it's a gain and a net gain for everyone in the community. Because they are sharing information, they are securing the network. So we think that leeching itself is not really a problem. And we have seen some, I would say, bad example, and that's what I was mentioning before. It's, yes, sometimes you have sharing community that start, you have a bootstrap, and then it died slowly or it died directly. We had an example with one national sharing community where they decided as a rule that people must share information in order to benefit information, or at least to be able to get information. And this model is super dangerous. For one of the reasons of having such kind of model, and which is, I think, quite problematic, is when people have to keep a certain threshold to maintain their work or to being able to get the data, they will push any data. So for example, it's not uncommon, then they will find an OSINT report that's already there. Four times, they will push the data again. So again, putting a threshold on such kind of things is forcing people to behave badly. And at the end, is sometimes people are sharing when they need to share, when they have something interesting to share. So you might lose organizations. If you force them to share and so on, those might be valuable contributors in 1 year or even 2 years. So because you see that to reach a level of 30% of contributions is not coming the first year. Usually after 2 or 3 years that you see that a lot of people are contributing. So another thing is, if you start a sharing communities and it doesn't work the first month, don't kill it. I mean, you have many ways to just like be sure that people are collaborating and so on. It takes time. That makes sense. I mean, it's a human process at the end. So again, to summarize the aspect of to convert passive organization into active one, wait for it to come. Because if you do organic growth, at some point, the organization will start to think, okay, I have a lot of information from other organizations. Maybe I should start to work. And we had some interesting cases about some organizations sharing very specific type of information, and receiver of the information were like, but how can I use this information? Because I have no capabilities of that. But by sharing, you force indirectly other organizations to increase their capabilities. So lead by example is, again, very interesting. Another thing that is important is giving credit. We have seen communities that are, for example, hiding the credit. So for example, they have an ISAC, they revamp all the data, and the original author or analyst is not credited. And to be honest, this one is an incredible demotivator when you work in the field and you are doing some incident response, sharing things and so on. So it's really, really, really important that to give credit to people. It makes a lot of sense, but sometimes people are removing the name of people because they're afraid that, you know, Chatham's rule, or they don't want to disclose the name. But be careful about that, because if you remove credit, you might run into very funky problems. We have seen like some communities really acting badly. And one of the analysts was super upset about it. He started to encode in MD5 his full name into the MISP object attribute. So you see, keep that in mind. Giving credit is super important. We already mentioned that before about the difficulties and so on. But I mean, the thing that is one of the most important, and I think Sami had like a very good point on that, technical information is great, is a nice talent. However, you really want to add additional information, especially to contextualize it. Because when you contextualize it, you know exactly what you could do with the information. So IDS flag, for example, in MISP is quite important, but you want to go a bit further. What is the target? What kind of information that you can have? What is the kill chain? What are the techniques and so on? So really help that. And again, if you proper classify the information, label it and so on, for the recipient of the information, it's much more easy for them to deal with that information. And it's useful at the end. Again, if you set, for example, a level of estimative language, and some people say, oh, if people have doubt about the data, I prefer to discard it instead of, you know, ingesting it into my system. So that's such kind of contextualization is always useful. Again, the vocabularies, and this one is for me, for the most successful sharing communities have their own taxonomies, labels, and so on. They have a versatile system, so they define it and so on. So, and that's the thing that some people are like a bit crazy about when they see MISP for the first time. Oh, you have so many taxonomies, I won't enable all of those. Obviously, you won't enable all of those. If you go to a library, you pick a certain set of books. You don't want to look at all the categories from cooking up to quantum cryptography. So you do the same exactly with MISP and the taxonomies. I think we have around more than 200 taxonomies nowadays. And I think on a normal instance, you might enable, I don't know, 10, 12 taxonomies, especially for the workflow and so on. So just really pick and choose the taxonomies. You can even select a subset in the taxonomies. I have a good example for that. For some military classifications, you just want, for example, to be allowed to use one, like unclassified. So you can even cherry pick in the complete list, for example, of NATO classifications, just the unclassified one. And this process is super, super important. If you could not find a vocabulary, create your own. I mean, in MISP, you just create the JSON files. There's no need of knowing how to program and so on. You can create your own, keep it for yourself. If it makes sense, don't hesitate to make a pull request for us. I mean, the majority of taxonomies that we have nowadays are not coming from us. They're coming from partner organizations actively using it. Again, same with galaxies and shared galaxies. We are maintaining a thread actor information. It's not the ground truth. It's really a good summary of all thread actors. It's a combined list of various things. But if you want to collaborate on that, feel free. We have a pretty large one for ransomware, exploit kit, things like that. We have others like preventive measures or actions, which could help even analysts or people receiving this information. Okay, what should I do with those indicators? If I have no way to detect those, but the preventive measures to verify it if you have it on your infrastructure is to do that, for example. Can you check and so on? So it's really interesting there. And again, we have plenty of default ones thanks to projects like Attack from Maitre. You can really create your own classifications. Again, you can even fork galaxies nowadays, so you can even extend a specific tradactor database, keep it for yourself, share it with others. It's what we call Galaxy 2.0. And it's really a nice way to do contextualization and so on. Again, false positive. False positive, it's a long discussion. And I see already at the beginning of the session, we had some question about false positive because it's, I would say, a common problem. But the main problem of false positive is not the false positive themselves, it's the definition of false positive per organizations. I'm sure that Sami and I we have a different set of definition of false positive depending on what we do even. So for example, false positive can be annoying for some specific activities. Sometimes things are false positive because you don't want to deal with those, but sometimes they are not. I take an example. You might have domain names that are basically on a parking page, but the attackers know that. So depending on your geolocation, they will forward you to a specific portal or parking pages. But if you are the specific target, then they are forwarded to the CNC or stuff like that. So keep that in mind. It's interesting to have different view on false positive. And that's why we have this kind of model with a warning list. You can really ingest informations and have warnings helping you to basically better qualify the informations. We have really a specific rule in MISP and that we have seen in a lot of sharing community that is really useful. It's basically be lenient on when considering what to keep or to accept, but be strict when you are feeding tools. So in MISP, you have this kind of warning list filter, so you can enforce a warning list on the API access. So that means if any data is matching one of the warning lists, it won't be at the end into your output. But we keep it open because, again, it's depending on your use case, and those kind of false positive definitions might vary between the different use cases. Just a thing, it's false positive handling and so on. What we have seen is sometimes indicators that were like completely useless like 2 or 3 months ago just pop back. Because, for example, some attackers like to re-register domains that were already with a kind of lifetime, and you see that then they are reused again. So you have systems that are going back and forth into infected, non-infected, and so on. So you need to handle that. And maybe Sami will show it to you about expirations and especially sightings with expirations. It's really one way to avoid that. Is if you have multiple sightings that a lot of people say, oh, I've seen it, it's obviously interesting for many people. Another thing that you should not be afraid to is in sharing communities, you might have different bubbles. You have different ways of doing it. And that's really the goal of sharing groups. Sami showed to you sharing groups or their use, what you can do with those, and so on. And those sharing groups can really be a nice way to share or limit information sharing for different reasons. Topic-wise, I mean, for example, you have a sharing community for the private sector with the banking sector. So, for example, when you share bank account, legally-wise, so for example, legally, you cannot share information. So you create your specific sharing group there. And of course, you can really create your own sharing groups and so on. We have seen a lot of sharing communities giving the right of creating sharing groups to a lot of organizations. So like that, everyone can set up their own group for ad hoc basis and so on, and the system allow it. It's really, really interesting there. Another thing is sometimes you want to create indirect connectly communities where you want to have kind of manual data transfer. We have seen some community like that where they have like strict rules for one group is more lax, and then the data transfer is like a way to do the filtering out of it. And obviously, when you start the sharing communities, create guidance from the early beginning. Like example of events, what kind of information to share, and obviously take the initiative. Creating your first event. I've seen some organization where the secretariat itself is acting as a creator of event. They see something interesting, creating it and so on, and it's really giving the others like a kind of impulse to contribute and share back there. So if you want to share a community, start a sharing communities, NISAC, things like that, don't hesitate to get in touch with us. We can help. We are doing that for various communities. Our goal for us is really straightforward. We are a third. We want that people are collaborating, exchanging informations. And if they share more informations, people start to be better productive. So those building of sharing communities are really important. Don't hesitate to follow us on Twitter, on GitHub, and so on. We have plenty of activities there. You'll see that the project is super active. So don't hesitate to join us. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to create an issue, start a discussion on GitHub, or start and connect to Gitter. We have 3 rooms nowadays, especially for sharing, for more the development aspect, bugs report, and so on. So don't hesitate to reach out to us. Okay, so that's it for the building sharing communities. Do we have any questions or things like that?
No, we don't.
Okay. So, I mean, don't hesitate even to continue to ask questions. And I will give back the floor to Sami to quickly show how to use event reports and so on, which is a very, very nice feature. Okay, technology is working, right? And he will show you how to use event reports for the trade analysis. It's very interesting because it's really, I would say, change the mindset of having like unstructured report and structured reports is really being able to combine those two things together.
Perfect, thank you. Okay, so I will quickly go over event reports. You will see how it is powerful and how you can actually merge description, stories, anything that you can write in English or whatever language with actually data that is saved inside an event. So for that, I have picked the Cobalos event that you have. If you want to see it, it's also in the pad. I will paste the link quickly. There we go. And so what you can see in this event, we have a bunch of contextualization. We have some tags, we have objects, we have attributes, pictures, and so on. If you look at the event graph, you can see that we have some relationship between entities. And I think we even have some timeline sets. But something that we overlooked when we were presenting is the event report section. So you can see by default, it's closed unless the event contains a report. So if you want to create an event report, you have to click on this event report button, and then you can start interacting with this widget. So let's have a look at this Cobalos event report. We just click on it, and then it opens up a modal that contains the actual report. So what you can see is it's a report, it's formatted, and it can contain a lot of different ways to highlight and mark data. So for example, we can see we have a reference here to a galaxy. If you click on it, you can have more information about this galaxy. We have a reference to an existing object attribute, so an object that is contained inside an attribute. And so you can see that we can have immediately the object type, the attribute that is being used, and its value displayed in the report itself. And it's completely interactive, meaning that if you see, if one of them has some tags, you will see them, same for comments and so on. You can also reference tags belonging to taxonomies, pictures. Well, you see it's pretty complete. Now let's have a look at what it actually looks like whenever you are creating an event. So we can see it's marked down basically. We can go into the split screen. So in fact, an event report is just text that is correctly interpreted by a markdown parser with an additional thing is it also supports a special syntax to reference MISP entities, such as tags, attributes, MISP objects, and so on. So it supports all the basic markdown features, such as highlighting, italics, bold, tables, and so on. So if you want to add a table, it's quite straightforward. You can either do it manually or use the small helper that we have. And so it will create a table immediately. And to reference entities that are saved inside an event, you can use this shortcut. So for example, if you wanted to reference an attribute, you can click on this small one. It will pre-fill using the special MISP syntax to reference one. And then you have access to some suggestion. You can just pick one. And you can see that with the UID of the attribute, it immediately converted it into something that you can interact with. So we have that for attributes. We also have that for objects. For example, I don't know this file. And you have access to the object in the report. We also have that for tags. So these are all the tags that are contained inside the event. But if you want to reference another one, you can still do it. For example, TLP red is not used in this event, but you can see that you can still reference it and have the information about this tag. Okay, so this is again another one, a nice addition on how you can enrich even more your event and contextualize it even more and provide more the description. But something that is also actually very cool is that you can also create event starting from a report immediately. So to do that, leave the page. I will create an event and show you immediately how it works. But first, I just want to grab the URL. If I have it somewhere, yes, I do. Let's take it. So let's add another event. Add event, example event report. It's a typo, no, it's not a big issue. So let's click on event report. And then you can see you can do multiple things. You can either create a report with a name, the distribution, obviously, and then its content. Or you can also import a report, an event report from a specific URL. So if you have a look at what you have in this URL, it's a report, a blog post made by Essets about Cobalos, a malware, and it describes this malware, what it does with the MITRE attack techniques and so on. And what you can do in MISP is immediately import it from this URL. So you click on import from URL, you paste the URL in this input box, you submit it. And what MISP does, it will go on this website, fetch the HTML, try to parse it and transform HTML into Markdown and then save it. So if we have a look, now this is the report that I've been just saved. You can see that you have still to do some cleanup, like remove unwanted stuff, correct the section and so on. It really depends on how the blog post was formatted using HTML. That you can do, it's quite straightforward to do. But then what you can do with this report is to start to create attributes and objects from this report and save them into the event. So if we look at the event, we can see that we have the event report that we imported, but we still don't have any attributes or objects. But what you can do is, if you go into menu and then extract entities, we can perform a manual extraction, and it will propose you context that you can attach to the event. So for example, this one, Galaxy Sector Infrastructure Defense. This one picked up the Cobalos malware that is saved as a Galaxy cluster. And you can also extract data itself. So for example, these payload deliveries as a URL. So let's see where it is in the document. So it's here. And if you want, you can click extract and save. And what it will do, it will transform this raw text value into an attribute and reference it back into the report. So let's see how it works in practice. We apply the suggestion. We go back in the data extraction. We don't see the SSH door .ev that we replaced, but you can see now in the report, it has been referenced. And if we look back at the event, we can see that the attribute has been created. So instead of working inside this event and create attributes one by one, you can work directly from a report a text report and extract entities and context immediately from that interface and then save it into an event. Okay. Just before closing this session, I just want to also have a quick overview on how you can search for data, because we've been spending the last 4 hours encoding stuff, but how can you export and how can you search for something? So you have multiple ways to do it. So if we go back inside an event, if you are already inside an event that you want to search for something, well, we have this search box here that you can use. So to provide a better example, I will take the spear phishing attempt. If you want to search, for example, for Mr. John, you can just type John and then it will search and returns you all attributes or objects containing the keyword that you just searched for. This is for an event. Now, if you want to search for an attribute value and you don't know if it already exists in your instance, you can do it from the main interface that lists all the events. So you can go into search attributes. And then you have this complex form, which allows many parameters. But the most easiest one is just to search on a following value, on a provided value. You can take the time to read it to see what this form is capable of, but basically you can really refine your search, for example, with type of attributes, category, with the first time something was seen, the last time it was seen, with some specific tags and so on. But let's just search for John. If we submit, we'll have a list of all the attributes in this instance with the value of John. And then you can pivot from this interface to quickly see all the events where these attributes, well, all of these attributes are contained. Okay, so this is for searching for value using the UI, but most of the time you will either use this interface or use a script or another tool to search for data that you have stored in MISP. And to do that, we have an extensive API documentation and API testing interface. You can access all of them with this API top menu. If you go in Open API, it will load all the essential documentation, which is pretty exhaustive, actually, that are in MISP, providing some guidance on how you can perform requests against MISP, how you can search for data using the various endpoints. And if you don't have, if you're not familiar with curl and don't have a tool such as, now I'm having a, don't remember the name of the tool, Mailman. Yes. For example, Mailman is a great tool to perform API queries. But if you don't have, MISP already support a built-in client that can help you to perform this kind of query. So it supports a list of templates where you can have documentation. So for example, if you want to search for a specific attribute, you will probably use the attribute REST search. Then you can see that you have documentation on how you can use this endpoint, what kind of return format you want to receive, because MISP is really flexible on what you can export. So you can choose to export it into the standard MISP format, but you can also export it into CSV, NetFilter, JSON, Suricata, Yara rules, and so on. It's very flexible. And for the parameters for filtering your data, it also supports a plethora of different ways to filter. So you can filter off data based on the time, based on if it trips any warning on the warning list, based on tags, types, and so on and so forth. It's really flexible. And then you can try it out in this interface. So for example, if I want to have in a CSV format, I will only request the first 10 John Doe. Let's say John. Oops. Can delete anything else. And I will ask to show the result. Oops. Almost there. Ah, obviously, you have to provide an API key. So just to show you quickly. To generate an API key, you go into Global Action My Profile, and then you can click on Auth Key. You can create an authorization key. You copy it, and then you can use it. If I was a bit too fast for the API key generation, don't worry, everything is described in the Open API section. And then you can see if you run the query, you can have all the 10 first attributes that contain the value John. Yeah, I think that's it. One last thing that I want to mention, because it has been mentioned multiple times regarding indicator lifecycle management, is that MISP by default already support fairly complex method, but also very flexible technique to actually filter out data that you don't want to have or that the system considers as being expired. So to do that, I have an example that is also contained in the pad, but I will also paste it so that we also have access to it. So this is just an event that contains some IP addresses where these IP addresses receive some sightings. And if you click on the TK score, you can see that it will compute some score for different models that you can create and interact with. So let's have a look at one. So for example, right now we are viewing an interface that shows us the current score, which is 12. You can see it on the graph for that specific attribute for a specific model. So if we change the model and we take, for example, the model name fast expiration, you can see that it behaves quite differently. We have also phishing models. You can see that it really behaves differently. And to have expiration based on the time something was last seen, you are relying on the sightings. So you can see that it's been a long time since this attribute received a sighting. But we can, if we add one, so let's add one just for the sake of this example. So we created the sightings. If we were to resimulate the decay score of this attribute, we can see that it received the sighting, the score has been reset. The score is now set to 79, meaning that this attribute is not expired. And you can have a projection in at which time the attribute will be marked as decayed by the model. So yeah, we have plenty of options to configure these. It's pretty extensive. If you want to have more information, I invite you to go in the documentation about the decay example. We have also a full slide deck about it. I will paste the slide deck in the chat in a minute. Decay of indicator. Yep, that's it. So take the time to read it. It's a fairly complex topic, but set it up correctly, I think it's a very nice gain, especially when you are exporting data directly to other tools like ADS or SIM. Okay, so we are 5 minutes late, but I think we pretty much cover most of the important concept and aspect of MISP. Do we have any questions?
Yes, we have one. It's regarding trainings and so on. So we can arrange training for different organizations. So we do kind of regular general trainings on a quarterly basis for different groups in different languages. So we can do it in French, German, Luxembourgish, and Spanish. So if you're interested in one of the different languages, just send an email to info@circle.lu. We can arrange. So when we do public trainings like we do today and so on, it's just free trainings. If you want custom one, I would say more specialized for a specific group and you don't want to disclose to others and so on, then we have to cover our cost. Then we can arrange something. Just drop an email to us and we will arrange that. So it was to answer the question of Akizi. Okay, so thank you very much. The session is recorded, so it will be supposed available at some point in time on YouTube channel of FIRST. Again, thank you very much. Thanks again to the logistic of FIRST for the organizations and especially for all the team taking care of all the work and so on. I know it's difficult online sometimes. So thank you very much, and it was good to see you there. And I hope that we will see you soon using MISP and collaborating with others. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.